Hey, we're live on YouTube. This is Ari the Rugged Man, and I'm here with horror maniacs Adam Green, director of Hatchet 1, 2, and 3, Frozen. He's a maniac, movie nerd, psychopath like us. We got Gabe Bartalos.
Hi, Ari.
He worked on, you know, a lot of my favorite movies, Frankenhooker, Bass Case, Brain Damage, of course, The Hen and Lot of Staple, but, you know, makeup on Leprechaun and worked on a ton of shit. We're going to go deeper into that later, but we're going to just get the conversation going. How you doing today, fellas?
Great.
Good.
Yep. So Adam Green, I did his podcast years ago, but their podcast with Joe Lynch is a little bit more legit than mine. I'm just kind of winging it. So they talked about serious shit. Like, they talked about my family and the kids dead in my family and Agent Orange and all the serious shit. And I was, like, almost annoyed. Like, let's talk about nerdy horror shit. And it's like, no, but we must talk about your life. So it was, like, about my life. I'm like, this is fucking boring, my life.
But people loved it.
I want to talk about, like, you know, Deadly Friend, you know, the basketball scene and, you know, Ann Ramsey's head blown off. So Adam Green, Gabe Bartalos, we're just going to randomly talk about horror shit. So we're going to start off with an easy one. Wes Craven.
Shocker.
That's you like Shocker?
Yeah. And look, I know it's a flawed movie. Like, the last 20 minutes are flawed. But Horace Pinker, such a badass character.
Wow.
And that soundtrack just fucking slays. Dangerous Toys, Alice Cooper. You got members of Kiss. You got a Megadeth cover of an Alice Cooper song. Wow. I mean, that was like awesome, and unfortunately the movie never hit.
But the only thing I remember is the bite and the lip off.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Do you think I remember they positioned that film as like the new franchise character? Do you think that cursed it a little? Because
yeah,
I agree,
yeah,
that had potential, and I wonder if it's too manufactured, people rebel against it, or it has to be organic. What do you think?
I think the problem was Freddy, Jason, Michael, they were already starting to like wear on people, and no one was really in the mood for another one at that point. Not until Scream came along.
Yeah.
But it's unfortunate that most people don't even know that movie. But why, when they were doing nothing but remakes for like a good 12-year period, was that not one of them?
Mm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But the ending is admittedly silly, but it also gave us Peter Berg as an actor. But he might have never become the director he is. We might never have Battleship.
Yeah.
If not, I love Battleship.
I met him at the Mercer Kitchen once, and I was like, "Hey, you know, you're directing now." And he acted like a diva. Maybe he was having a rough day. So
you never know.
Maybe, you know. But I was like, come on, fuck Battleship. No, I'm just kidding. But Wes Craven, Deadly Friend. I know that's a flawed film as well.
Sure.
But has some of my favorite shit in the world. It's like an after school special with a fucking robot.
Do you think they glued her fingers, or you think that was just acting chops? What do you think?
Scotch tape.
Yeah.
Honestly, Wes Craven, when he became the face of horror in the 90s, I wasn't a fan of the Scream movies.
Really? The first one?
So I kind of was rebelling, kind of like hating on Wes in my head. But then when you know, as it went on, I look back, I go, nah, you know what? If he did Last House on the Left for $90,000, and then did Hills Have Eyes for $120,000, and then did Nightmare on Elm Street for $1.2 million, like, and retired then, he's a master. He's one of the greats, just off of those three alone, you know, for what you did for no money independently. So I give Wes Craven his props. Plus, he made a lot of fun, silly shit in between all of that, too. Like,
yeah, he was great, man.
Have you ever worked with Wes or?
No, but I did like Ernest Borgnine's beard in Deadly Blessing.
Wow, you know, I don't remember much about the film except the spider scene, you know, Deadly Blessing. Did you ever see Deadly Blessing?
I know I saw it. I don't remember it.
It was like the Amish spider scene. It was like the Amish community, and Sharon Stone was in it.
Yeah,
it was the you know, the 180 to Witness.
Yeah.
That would be the double feature.
Did you ever see The Devil's Reign with Ernest Borgnine?
Sure. Yeah.
It's like a TV movie, and they all melt. They're like Satan worshippers, and they melt.
No, I never saw that.
Yeah.
It's genuinely good.
Yeah.
It's Severin put it out.
Oh,
so
they did?
Yeah, in a restoration. And it's funny. I had a VHS of it for years that looked like it went through a nuclear plant, and I kind of kept it that way because they said, how good can this film look? So the tape really was stepped on, and I just kept it like that. Like, that's how it probably looks. So my jump from zero to a fully restored thing was like, oh, this is a good film, and it has some really great visuals. And what, 4 seconds of John Travolta? One of his first? He's in the back of a car for 4 seconds.
Sometimes you don't want to see a 4K. The best example, of course, is Flash Gordon. I mean,
you see all the strings or something?
God.
Is that what it is?
Awful. Yeah.
I feel that way about El Topo.
Really?
Yeah. Like, the cleaner it gets, I like that film. I keep going to it. And I think I like it more as a rough and ready. I think it's more of a time capsule of what he was up against than what it looks like. Because the cleaner it gets, almost to me, I'm just reaching here, but texturally feels like it's not symbolic of how it was made and who he was made back then.
Interesting. I've never seen anything higher than just regular DVD quality of that.
To me, it's getting too good. Yeah.
That can happen.
And it's a great film.
Oh, yeah.
There's something about it being struggling to be seen, even through your screen, that I think it benefits from.
Yeah. Okay, so did you give us a Wes Craven one?
Yeah, his beard.
Oh, Ernest Borgnine. Yeah. Okay.
And I stand by that one.
Hooper, not Chainsaw Massacre.
I'm going to get controversial right out of the gate and say Poltergeist.
Oh, you love Spielberg. E.T. is your favorite movie of all time. That scared me when I heard that. I was like, E.T.'s his favorite movie of all time? There's something weird going on there. No, I'm just kidding.
So are you saying it's controversial because...
Because everyone tries to say, well, Spielberg really directed it because it doesn't seem like any other Toby. Like, Spielberg produced it. His hands are definitely on it. Mm-hmm. But everybody, including Spielberg, say Toby Hooper directed that movie. Mm-hmm. So
There's a whole Twitter account that fights for Hooper. It's like Hooper made Poltergeist at whatever, and they show articles still. Like they fight, and everyone's like, whenever someone says Spielberg directed it, he jumps into conversations like and sends them all information. So
good.
There's a guy that's really adamant that Hooper directed the
film.
If you see this,
keep up that fight, man. keep it up.
If that is true, I'll match you because I love Poltergeist. I saw it years ago when they did the re-release in the theaters.
Oh, it's so good.
It had the same impact. In fact, I enjoyed parts of it more with adult eyes as to what was happening from the filmmaking process. And it hit all the beats that a commercial film should. And people dismiss commercial films, but that's hard to do.
It's like a
hit single. You make fun of pop songs, go ahead and try and write a pop song that everyone's humming. It's hard. So, I'm with you on that.
Yeah, whenever people make fun of one-hit wonders, and I'm like, everyone alive knows that song. Yeah. You've had bands on album 13 still touring like theaters
trying to figure it out.
Sheds, and nobody knows their shit except for their fans.
Totally.
Yep. Eating Alive. Did you ever see Eating
Alive? Yeah, it's great.
Robert Englund. Oh, you got to see it.
One of Robert Englund's first movies.
He's a famous actor in the cowboy days or whatever. He plays the crazy guy with the sickle in the movie. I don't know. Whoever he was incredible in it. And Kim Richards plays like a little girl, or maybe her sister, one of Richards' girls, like plays a kid hiding under an alligator's trying to eat her, and it's really sleazy.
Cool.
And Robert Englund, you know, Freddy Krueger, he plays Buck, and he has like a belt buck, and I like to fuck, you know?
Yeah.
You know, so I love Eating Alive. And Funhouse, I never loved the film. I always thought it was cool, and I don't know what happened.
The poster's better than the movie.
No, but I got COVID, like 2021 or something, and I was sitting there dead, and I was like, watch Funhouse, and I fucking loved it. I don't know how it hit. It just hit me. I haven't seen it since it came out.
I think I was just looking for something different when I was younger. I wanted a hardcore wall to wall.
Yeah, more. It doesn't deliver. It is slow too.
Yeah.
But I really loved it when I had COVID.
So, the character pulled me.
Life Force.
Yes. Life Force is great.
I didn't mean to cut you off.
Sorry for Funhouse. When they were doing the Gremlins, I think like the 30th anniversary of it. Empire Magazine arranged this interview at Rick Baker's shop, and it was Chris Whalis and Rick Baker, Joe Dante, and Zach Galligan. And Zach had just been in Hatchet 3, and he's like, do you want to come? And I'm like, why would I be there? He's like, just, you know, hang out. So we go in, and Rick's shop was closing at that point. So everything was still in there, but it was completely empty. So they start the interview, and Rick's like, Adam, if you want to go look around, just go look around. So I had free reign of Rick Baker's shop.
Wow.
And, like, in his office, right behind the desk, is that head from Funhouse.
Wow.
But it's like a museum in there, the way everything's lit and everything. Yeah. Mighty Joe Young. But then the one thing that isn't, like, behind glass or, like, lit is Amber Tamlin's body from The Ring, that one shot where her head's just like behind a door. It scares the shit out of you. So great. But yeah, one of the best days of my life.
And that makeup is phenomenal. That's one of the best monsters, though. The
split face.
It's a great design.
And and what was genius, he wore the Frankenstein monster mask before, and he had clearance because I think did Universal do the film, I think, but I don't remember. Maybe I'm wrong, but I believe Universal did the film, so they were able to use the Frankenstein imagery with no problem as well, you know. But Life Force, what'd you think about that film?
ambitious.
Yo, when I was 11, that was the nicest breast I ever seen in my life. Though. The space vampire, when she got up, I was like, yo, tits cannot be better than that. I was like, will I ever touch something like that in my life? You know, like 11 years old, jerking off the space vampires. Space vampire. And then she turned into a monster. Yeah,
that's the proper rite of passage.
Okay. John Landis.
I mean, American Werewolf. I don't know how... but I mean, are we talking Landis horror stuff or Landis?
Just,
oh God.
It's hard because really he has winners in every category.
Every category.
Like Animal House kind of nails it more than Blues Brothers. Well,
Henenlotta, when he talked about Landis, he said, yo, when Animal House hit, he was like, everybody knew that was something that was a game changer. He said Animal House was a game changer, you know. And Henlotta is not easy to, you know. He was like, yo, Animal House.
Well, that only because it hits the right beats so many times. Like, if a film has three or five, that's pretty remarkable. That film, you could almost count the times it misses. Like, it's so consistently on. Like, when a person hits the zeitgeist, there it is in play, I think. Because it's kind of... And I know people maybe older than me or slightly younger who are just finding it because they're on a different wave and equally freaking out and quoting about it. I'm like, wow, that's bizarre.
That's the thing about that movie. You could see it once and quote like five or six things instantly.
Yeah.
And Belushi, I mean, just like in his prime, like just hilarious.
Yeah, it's all there. American Werewolf is amazing. But you know what? I will put it to one shot, one scene in Kentucky Fried Movie
is where Big
he takes the giant dildo and says, are you aware of the penal codes in this state? And waves it in their face.
Kentucky Fried Movie was genius.
So ridiculous.
I always, it's bad. My kids, they watch stupid shit with me. They didn't see the sex parts, but like sometimes there's a funny skit. Like, they did the Bruce Lee parody in it. My son is like, show me a notch. shut up, kid.
Also, fucking Thriller.
Thriller, yep. And you know, the wife, Deborah, did the fucking Michael Jackson jacket.
Yeah, and the Indiana Jones.
Indiana Jones and the whip. Yeah, right. She was nominated for Oscar, or I don't know if they won or nominated, but for Coming to America, all the wardrobe.
Yeah. What's amazing about Thriller, though, is even though I don't know how familiar you guys are with it because it wasn't as big. But Michael Jackson's Ghost, which was like 35 minutes long, Stan Winston directed it, which had like five times as much money thrown at it, and it's just absolutely bonkers, still not as good as Thriller. Because what Landis did is he let Michael dance. He held things in wide shots. Because after you saw that video three times, we all knew the friggin' dance. But you could see Ghost 50 times, and maybe there's a couple parts that you might be able to emulate. Right. Not it's me. Funny. I can't dance.
No one remembers that. It just slipped away. There's such big production going on in that.
It also came out at a time when the first accusation had come out. He hadn't, like, that all that stuff. So I don't think it was shown as much here.
Right. It was probably harder to get behind
also,
it.
Also with John was, I think... He had the experience from Blues Brothers working with, you know, Aretha Franklin and stuff. He was working with James Brown. You know, he was working with all these great entertainers. So I think he was getting used to the dance numbers and learned them and knew how to make.
Probably knew that's why they were coming. Like, make sure you give them what they want.
He, I think in an interview he said something like, he actually said told the executives we need time to do rehearsals with the dancers because when I was on Blues Brothers, we didn't rehearse one scene. You know, we got amateur dancers, and I said, okay, we got to get real dancers. I might be twisting the story, but But Landis made a lot of great stuff. Larry Cohen.
This is going to be another unpopular one because it doesn't really count, but the documentary about Larry Cohen, King Cohen, fucking fantastic.
I haven't seen that. It's great.
Oh, yeah. It is so good because you don't even realize how much stuff he did or had to... his hand in or things that he wrote. Or
right, what, that's like, where it almost confused me, because I'd see his name as a writer, then I'd see he kind of nurtured a project, then I'd know the horror films.
Yeah.
And I was always impressed by, is it, and God told me to?
What's yeah, that? Yeah, with God the vagina, to. Jesus with the vagina
well,
thing.
I like the part where they like, stole the footage at the St. Patty's Day.
Oh, yeah, parade. Yeah. Like, Andy Kaufman's in it, too.
Yeah, to me, yeah. I'm like, right there is filmmaking, because they're doing it in 35, so you could only hide so much, even if it's a handheld camera. Someone's burning calories running around with that camera.
Yeah.
And, you know, there, however many shots there are, there's not a lot to tell you, but they're there. They're really grabbing that footage, sneaking yeah. it. And so, yeah.
The stuff. Great. The stuff.
Yeah. Exciting.
What'd you think about stuff? Oh, yeah. The stuff is so good. I love that they sell it now. Like, yeah. you can buy little, things of it. Yeah.
It's a live trilogy. Mm-hmm. Black Caesar.
Q is him, too, right?
Q, yeah, Q, yeah. The Winged Serpent. Yeah.
I love Larry, man. I love Larry. So, what is... horror sequel that is better than the original?
Well, we were just talking before this started. Not that it's better than the original, I guess, but Exorcist 3, I don't know, I held up four fingers, 3. after the second one was so underwhelming.
John Borman's one of great directors, too, and he made that, yeah.
But the third one is so good. Mm-hmm. And, like, nothing's going to beat the first
original,
one.
Of course.
But yeah. The third one is so good, and there's so many people who haven't seen it because the second one disappointed them. Other sequels that were
also, I don't even know if it's just because of the second one. I think the third one was also like an intellectual film, and it doesn't deliver the ooga booga like
it's got the one. Best so, one of the best so scares.
In
the hallway.
The hallway one.
Great, yeah.
But I think it's not as commercial as an Exorcist one, even though it's a smart, good movie.
Yeah.
So maybe I'm, you know, but that's what I think. I think people, you know, after having their lives scared out of them in the first one, I think maybe 3 was...
Well, it's hard. It's a no-win situation.
Yeah.
Because even to change course and make a genuinely good film like 3 was, if it's different, it'll stand on its own, but there's no way it's not going to be compared.
Yeah.
And you're... It's just a tough job to say yes to that.
The other thing you're up against when you're making a sequel is the audience who loved the first one, they're different now. They're not the age, that they don't have the same things going on in their life. Yeah. And what they want is to feel exactly like they did when they saw the first one. And it's
the same
not
with music
happen.
As well. Yeah. If you do something different musically, like, I like your old, so just listen to the old shit.
Yeah, I already did that. You have it.
Yeah,
now here's this.
Yeah.
Evil Dead 2, I think
it's
better
than
the first one.
Yep, yeah, Prom Night 2, but it's not. It's just title a sequel.
Blade 2.
Oh, yeah. Guillermo
del Toro. Guillermo del Toro.
Yep. Do you got one? It's hard to think of.
I'm thinking.
Maniac Cop 2.
Oh, yeah. Hmm. I'd go with that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
If a light bulb goes on, I'll chime on it.
Yeah. It's not
a horror because movie, but Empire Strikes Back, much better.
Yeah.
Best one in the series.
Oh, yeah, we could go non-horror, too. Godfather 2, obviously. That's the one everyone says, you know. But there's something else in there. But it is what it is. We're just having fun. Oh, yeah. Suicide Disco. I'm trying to fund my film. ratheruggedmovie@gmail.com. If any investors are watching, you guys don't mind I shamelessly plug this, trying to
you
get
gotta
some,
do it.
I'm that self, was a smooth transition.
I'm self-financing.
And we've read it. He's even, can I say that?
Yeah, of course.
He's working on it.
Yeah, Gabe Bartalos
is
doing
fucking crazy.
Yeah, I sent it to Adam very early when I first said, can you want to read something? And he really...
innocently hit download.
I knew it would be messed up, mm-hmm. so I was ready for it. But it had heart.
Yeah.
Like, it's a good movie. It's not... Anybody can write something with messed up scenes or gore or, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a good... I actually liked the story. I didn't expect to.
Yeah.
I was like... Because when it started, I'm like, all right, I know what this is going to be. Because I was just thinking Headlotter type stuff. But it, like, if that's... if you never know, because so much can change in production and post and whatever,
mm-hmm.
but what you're starting with is so great and so unlike everything else that's out there right now. So yeah, if
invest.
You can support this movie, do it.
Well,
I have no stake in it.
I
just want to see it.
Oh, okay.
I think what Adam's saying is on point, that why, if there is the strong follow through and you get 85% of that on the screen, it's going to make a strong impact. But what struck me is, I guess the word is sentiment, or the, you're going into territories, there is the one lane of the shocking stuff that makes it exciting, especially as an effects guy to get involved in. But then as a project you want to be involved in, you go into territory that, I guess the question is it coming from parenthood? Is it coming from just having your eyes open to seeing relationships, to the way you consider loss, and you run it through your own filter that
where it came from is because I watched three people I love a lot bury their children. So I watched my father bury two of his kids. I watched my mom bury two of her kids together, you know, same kids, you know. But so I seen the way Dee, my stepmom, you know, but she raised me since I'm four. I seen the way she dealt with it. And I seen the way my father dealt with it. And then my sister buried her child. And I watched the way she dealt with it. So when I wrote the characters, it kind of, like, that was the easiest script I ever wrote because it just...
So all of those are echoes of you, your emotions. Were your emotions on the surface enough of your brain to look at them and go, I'm going to...
I didn't even realize it until afterwards. Okay, yeah. But you know the advice he gave me? The main advice he gave me? He was like, look, you have to... Whatever you do... Do not slack on the effects. He said, if you get these effects and this plays at a screening, the audience is going to go crazy. But if the effects, if you half-ass the effects.
It can't be trauma. Like, it's got to be.
That was the first advice. Well, good call. You're the most important piece, according to Adam.
Yeah, so. I think it's good advice, even removing myself out of it, because it's a letdown when a film is directed well and it's written well. And maybe the music syncs it, or the if it's leaning into the visual effects, if they sync it, those parts that are meant to be there to keep it afloat, it syncs it all the more. So, right on, loud and clear.
Yeah, what's a movie, and if you can't think of nothing, who gives a shit, you know, like, what's a movie that you thought was going to suck that turned out to be great? Anything come to mind?
There's a lot of those.
Name a couple.
I guess one of the best examples, so I loved Blair Witch when it came out because I got to see it before anyone knew what it was. And I just thought it was the greatest thing ever. And then when I started hearing about Paranormal Activity, I was like, I don't care. There's no way, like, Blair Witch was it. You can't do it again. And then thankfully I got to see that early as well, just watching, because you need to see it at home. Watching it in a theater is too safe. But I was terrified. Like,
wow.
And people get bent out of shape. They're like, those are the two movies that scared you? But they did. They did.
The movie that I remember the trailer as a kid, and I'm like, this looks like a stupid asshole kid movie. Fuck this movie. And it turned out to be one of the greatest movies ever, RoboCop.
Oh, yeah.
Like, when I saw the trailer, I'm like, a robot cop? Fuck this movie. What the fuck is this going to be? You know? And then I went to see it, and it's like blood, gore, you know, bitches leave, you know, cocaine and comedy. And it was like... I think I would see it three times in the theater, but I really thought it was going to be terrible.
You watched the documentary about it?
No, they made a
four-part series. It's like watching the movie get made in real time. And the most amazing story about this documentary is they didn't have Peter Weller till the last second. And so that's when they got his interview, and he is the whole thing, man. Like, the stories are so good.
Brightens up because of him, yeah.
Oh, God, the way they did.
I wonder if they had to show him the rough, and he knew it was real, and then he said yes.
I think that's what they said, that once they had stuff to show him that everyone else was in it. But, God, that it's even if you don't love RoboCop, it is so fascinating, like, you can't stop. Like, it's so good.
I read somewhere, I think, that... Verhoeven rejected it at first because that is Hollywood, you know, he was doing all the good art films but he wanted to do a Hollywood movie. And then, his wife said, this is Frankenstein. So don't quote me exactly, is what I remember reading, but it's something like that. And he took it into perspective as a Frankenstein picture, and then he hopped on board. That's what I heard.
It's amazing nobody died making it. And, like, you would never get away with what they did with explosions and squibs and stuff now. It would never happen.
Or like, you ever seen the documentary on all the Australian Ozploitation?
No.
Like, you know, like Mad Max and all that stuff, but, like, even the more obscure, less, like, they would, like, say you were standing there, they would literally, like, shoot bullets around your fucking head. Like, so you see the rocks coming out, but it was really shooting around your head. Oof. They would really, like, you got to watch that. They were, like, that was, like, the most dangerous shit you ever seen in your life. Like, just.
That's another one I could eat shit on was Fury Road. Oh, yeah. So when I heard...
I'm not a fan. Don't kill me.
Really?
Don't kill me.
Oh.
Don't kill me. Oh. I know the world hates me for that when I'm not a fan of Fury Road.
See...
I told Tom Hardy, I told him, I said, yo, Road Warrior is the best one. And he's like, ah, fuck you. Because he came out to one of our rap shows and was like, yo, I'm a big fan. I love the song Stanley Kubrick. He claimed that they were playing my music while they were making Fury Road. And I was like...
And then you insulted him?
I didn't say it was... I said Road Warrior is a masterpiece. Road War. I didn't tell him I didn't like Fury Road, but I just said Road Warrior is a masterpiece.
Yeah. He got
and I guess he got my energy. Yeah. I didn't mean it. I was trying to be a nice guy, you know?
I didn't expect it to be as good as it was, because when I heard, oh, you know, George Miller's going to do another one now, but Mel Gibson's not coming back, it's going to be a different guy. Immediately, I'm like, well, maybe for a new generation, but not for me. Mm-hmm. But then seeing that and just the spectacle of it, and that like an 80-year-old guy made that movie, his wife edited it. Mm-hmm. And hadn't she never even edited an action movie before or something?
I didn't know that. But beautiful. You know what it was is... I love the Road Warrior, like love it. And they said, oh, we're bringing it back to that and practical effects and all of this stuff. So I was like, I was actually very excited to see it. I was like, yo, I'm very, because Thunderdome is stupid as fuck. You know, there's like a couple funny moments, but it's a stupid fucking movie. But Mad Max is good. Road Warrior is a masterpiece. Thunderdome is whatever. And then Fury Road, I'm like, yeah. And I don't know. It just didn't do it for me. And you know what I think bothered me? And I'm not saying I'm right, because the world loves the film. Color correction and whatever the fuck they do to it. Like, supposedly stuff is practical, but it still looks like a fake painting of CGI. When a car's flipping and stuff, I'm like, is it CGI? Like, I couldn't... In Road Warrior, when a car's flipping, it looks like they put the camera down, the car's flipping, they're crashing, it just looked like real life. So, I'm weird.
There's a black and white version of it. I think it's called Silver and Chrome, or Black and Chrome version, like that.
Yeah, yeah.
You might be able to look at it differently without the... Because they did color it to be very orange and yellow, and then, like, blues in the background and stuff. So that... I understand what you're saying.
Mm-hmm. Most brutal film, or it doesn't even have to be the most brutal.
Let me give an answer on that, because I was, of course. You just bridged it with Tom Hardy. I'm a big Kubrick fan, and suddenly I started seeing the new Clockwork Orange, and it was for a film, Bronson.
I started
bristling. Like,
I've never seen the film. Is it good? I hear it's good.
It's very good.
Yeah. And, it's what made him a star.
The problem was I pushed back on it before I saw it or any judgment because... I'm like, don't start hanging on Kubrick's name. And Clockwork Orange is, like, really, to me, a great, great movie. So I was already wanting to dislike it. Yeah. And then I saw it, and I think they did a disservice to it, because it's its own film. Have you seen it?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, and that guy, Tom Hardy, it is a career-starting thing. He's very fun. The tone of it lands perfectly, because it's brutal. It has... Where the comedy is placed is in a weird place. It's in this violent guy. I think that's difficult, but it works. He's charming, but it's well made, and it's super weird. Like,
really weird.
It's really weird. And I was, my attitude was corrected. I was like, all right, this is genuinely a good movie.
That's funny. You know, I'm such a Charles Bronson fan, I get mad that I Google Bronson in that fucking movie. Yeah. I want Bronson.
It's the same thing. You should see it then, because they're both allowed to exist. Yeah. That's what I discovered.
I'm just weird. You know, like Jack Johnson, one of the greatest fighters, the first black heavyweight of all time. Mm-hmm. You Google him now, you see this little white guy with a guitar. I'm like, who the fuck is Jack Johnson? I want Jack Johnson.
But that's the
Google.
Point of your question. Right? That's the point of your question. What was one attitude and you got corrected? So
it doesn't have to be the most brutal, but what's a film that you saw young in age that fucked your head up, that you were like, whoa, it scarred you? That Or maybe the most brutal shit? Yeah, like something that was so brutal and fucked up or...
Okay. Well, I got two answers, because when I was... I'm going to answer more recently first, because I actually don't even like promoting it, but a Serbian film... The uncut version of that.
How old were you when you saw that?
Well, I saw that just a couple of years ago.
Newborn porn.
Yeah. It's not like certain things just aren't.
Did you see it?
Like,
no, I have it sitting there. A friend burnt it. It's just calling you,
okay,
my name.
Here's the thing. It's a well-made, like the confidence with which that movie was directed. Mm-hmm. Like, the dude's a serious filmmaker. It's a serious movie. But holy shit, you need a shower afterwards. Like, it is the worst things you can think of. when I was a kid, the two movies that fucked me up the most, one of them is the only time I ever had to walk out of a theater. This is so embarrassing. Okay, the first one, I was like 7 or 8, and my brother was watching The Thing, John Carpenter's Thing.
Yeah, of course, of course.
And when they started shooting the dogs to put them out of their misery, I was such a fucking mess.
You said the dog lover.
Yeah, a huge dog lover. And so they had, my parents had to shut it off, and I didn't watch another horror movie for like 3 years. Wow. I didn't want to go near it. Then a few years later, I go to see The Fly 2 in the theater with my friends. And there's that scene where he tries to teleport the dog and the dog's all fucked up and he's got to put it to sleep. I had to go wait outside. Like, just animal violence, I can't do it. And I'm not a big fan of...
So you're a big fan of Cannibal Holocaust?
No.
I'm just kidding.
No, I
didn't see that so much later.
That's what's interesting. It jumps to... Well, there is the first shot of the dogs getting shot. And they're meant to be the real dogs. When they become synthetic, you're...
That part didn't bother.
Yeah, you're in you know, Yahoo
it's
land.
It's the sound.
Right, the yelping the and screaming. And then picking at the fence. It is very disturbing. That's interesting. I'm a big dog fan as well. And it's funny, that never resonated. I think in my mind, maybe being so focused on the effects and knowing how it was built from the early press, I think I disconnected very quickly because that's an easy way to lose a lot of an audience.
And I think it did at first. But if you watch that scene with your eyes closed, it's the most horrifying sounding shit ever.
Right, dogs in agony. And and then the siren goes off. And that's a really probably good study in sound design of everything's raising and raising and raising the stakes.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, I'll tell you, two of them of mine was Wizard of Gore. You know, Herschel Gordon Lewis.
Yeah.
It was big VHS tapes, and it was a big deal at the time. They actually had posters of it. They were promoting Herschel Gordon Lewis movies because Blood Feast and the box had the blood on it. And those were the scariest looking ones. And I brought home Wizard of Gore, and there's a scene where he's doing the saw down her throat, and she's like throwing up chunks of blood and stuff. Probably if I watch it today, it looks fake as shit, but I was probably 9 years old, 10 years old. And it just fucked my stomach up, and I felt so weird watching it. And then I kept renting it. I was like, why did they do that? It's one of my favorite movies because it fucked me up. And I can never remember the real title of it because Joe D'Amato, Buried Alive, was the title back in the day. Do you remember Buried Alive? Joe D'Amato film. I'll get you. I think it's Into the Darkness is the real title. And let me Google it real quick. What the fuck is the movie? But give me 1 second with the Googles because I have it, the real title at home and everything, and I can't remember what. Oh, Beyond the Darkness. There's this scene in Beyond the Darkness. I rented this as a kid, and this one just made me so nauseous. It was like, you know, he's ripping off fingernails, he's killing people, and it's gross, and it's so brutal, chopping off heads, pulling intestines out. It's like really a brutal film, especially like I said, 9 years old rented it. Because back in the day, they'd rent VHS tapes to us.
Yeah.
It didn't matter what it was, you know. And there's this one scene, like after this brutal killing in the tub and ripping intestines out, then there's the old lady and she's at the table like eating like this meat shit. And she's like, wah, wah, wah. And it's like, and it's just like, oh, it made me feel so disgusting. It like fucking traumatized me, you know. And then his necrophiliac, he's laying in the bed with that's the one that fucked me up. Do you have one from your childhood or something?
It's kind of a ridiculous one.
That's cool.
And I think... it's a film called Legend of Boggy Creek.
Oh, yeah.
And I saw that very young on my own. It was playing at the local theater. And, you know, maybe that was the first inclination that I got an overactive imagination because I saw, like, a different movie in my head. And
yeah, there's not much in it.
No, and I did these drawings of what this creature looked like, and it's this bug-eyed elephant tusk swamp creature. It's just a hairy pawn thing, right?
Yeah.
And I bought the DVD years ago and rewatched it and was like, what did my brain see? But it spooked me, and I think it's film's sheer rawness. You know, primitiveness.
Yeah.
Some like Chainsaw got in there. Like, is this real? What's going on?
They're gonna let you in live. They're letting you in.
Yeah,
right,
it's
now,
a
John.
Goofy one, but and also in the theater, I saw Saturday Night Fever, and the scene where the kid commit suicide off the bridge.
Oh. Yeah, that fucked me up.
Very,
too, as a kid.
Very disturbing to me. Probably me because of my age, and it was a well-made film, and just I probably hadn't seen something like that, you know. So to see legitimately good filmmaking, and the kid's so tragic. He's looking up to Travolta's character, or whatever. Yeah. And there was something about those shots when he slips into the darkness. I was like, wow. That guy. I was like, you know.
You know, the first thing that ever scared the shit out of me. I was probably 4 or 5. My dad said, "Oh, the Twilight Zone. They got cool endings." You know, and he used to let me stay up late because my mom and dad were divorced. I'd stay with him for the weekend. So it's like 1 in the morning. Watching the Twilight Zone, and the first one I ever seen was the Talkie Tina with Telly Savalas, you know, the killer doll. Did you ever see this episode?
Yeah.
And it's like, "Hi, I'm Talkie Tina. I don't like you." It was the scariest shit I ever seen in my life. Well, I was 4 or 5, but it's scary. That's what got me into horror for life. Like, I wanted to feel that again. And then she's like, "I'm going to kill you." It fucking fucked my head up. And you know what's crazy is I showed my son, like, horror. He knows Freddy, Jason, all of this shit. So I figured if I played it for him, I ruined it because I showed it to him too late. He won't be scared of it. But when I played it for him, in the middle of it, he was like, shut it off. I was like, "Whoa, Talking Tina got my son too." But then he said to it, he loved it. But, like, it got him too. I was like, oh.
It's funny how those things you see as a little kid. Because I think the thing that got me into horror was Disney's Legend of Sleepy Hollow. The cartoon, the animated one. The Headless Horseman. Even now, when you, like, that ending is terrifying.
Yeah.
It's absolutely terrifying. And then the fact that Ichabod dies. Mm-hmm. Like, he gets him. Wow. And, like, it's a cartoon. Yeah, that's not supposed to happen.
Yeah, that's not the normal, right. That's not the trajectory that's supposed to let you off.
Have you ever seen the Disney cartoon, The Mad Doctor? It was banned in Germany. It was banned in a bunch of places. Wow. There's this crazy doctor who kidnaps Pluto to cut his head off and turn him into a chicken. And at one point, like... And you got to see, it's on YouTube in its entirety now. At least it was a few months ago.
What was it, an animated feature for Disney? It's in the 40s
It's like a short.
50s?
It's maybe nine minutes.
Oh, okay.
But because it was made in the 30s, but it was so disturbing that they just like buried it right away. But it's messed up because Pluto's screaming and Mickey's trying to find him. And
really,
yeah, it's and there's like meat hooks and a table saw and like it's.
I love those that like sneak out somehow.
Yeah,
like someone in QC was asleep that day and like.
Isn't the licensing like on Mickey and everything coming to an end soon?
Well, not for Mickey, but for
or it's Mickey of the old era.
Yeah, what's his name? How am I forgetting
Goofy
this?
Winnie the Pooh.
Oh my God, this is gonna kill me now. The original name of Mickey Mouse.
Oh,
Steamboat Willie.
Oh, that's it. Yeah, yeah.
Because I was gonna say maybe remake it into a short. The Doctor.
You do a shot by shot.
Yeah, shot by shot.
Say, don't
film.
Get mad at us. They did it.
Yeah, they did it.
Yeah, we just did our psycho on it. You know,
movies that make you cry. He's like, I cry easy. Probably Old Yeller. You cried at Old Yeller, right?
Of course I did.
Oh, I know. That's entertainment part two because it sucked so bad.
I was going to say, I'm like, what?
Hey, man. How are you doing? John Hyams in the house, man. Adam said he had you and your father on the podcast.
Yes. Yeah, good to see you again. We were over Zoom then.
Yeah.
But...
yeah.
Good to see you.
What's good, man?
Where should I go?
So
let's get it.
I guess three minutes. Yeah,
we could slide down. Oh yeah, and go here. Oh wait, but the microphone's there.
I'll take care of that. If you guys just slide in, I'll squeeze them in.
Yeah, we'll squeeze them in there. And this isn't. There's no rules. We're just yapping about films and stuff like that. And you guys are having fun? We're kind of just
super fun.
Mm-hmm. Free spirited here.
Thanks, oh, really. I'll take care of that. Just go ahead.
Oh, one more chair.
Oh, okay. I got it.
Oh wait, have John go there. I got it.
Yeah.
That shout makes a lot more sense than all of us.
Gabe, John, how you doing?
Nice to meet you.
John, I think you worked with my usual first AD. I think it was sick. Craig Borden.
Yeah.
All he ever says, yeah, no.
Sweet guy.
Should I go more in?
Covering all the bases when he says that, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
There we go.
Just scoot in a little bit.
Thank you for coming,
I keep thinking
John.
It's going to fall over.
In person. What's up, man?
You as well, man. Good to see you.
I'll tell you, John Hyams made one of my favorite films of the decade, Universal Soldier's Day of Reckoning. It broke all the rules. It let you know. When you do a Universal Soldier sequel, you figure it's going to be some cliche. Yeah, you sell it around the world and just make a fucking Universal. No, it was like exploitation from sex to violence to... It's really, and it blew my mind, man. That's how I said, yo, that movie was fucking the best movie of the year when it came out. And it's like probably my one of my, it, not probably, it's one of my favorite films of that decade. Also, yeah. And I got it on 3D at the house because I got the 3D TV. So it's really, it's like, yeah. I can't show my son all of it. I showed you clips of me and my son watching in 3D, but I show him the car crashes, a couple of the fights, but there's a lot of R-rated stuff.
Yeah, my kids are not allowed to see anything I do.
It's a great one. Yeah. It's a great one.
I hope I have this right. I might be wrong. But did you do, was it the first episode of season two of Black Summer? Is that what it's called?
I did all, I created Black Summer.
So you did all of it?
Yeah, yeah. That, well, me that and Warner, Abram Cox, but I, yeah, I did that.
Fucking incredible. Yeah. Absolutely. Especially on a TV schedule and budget. How did you do that?
That one, we, that, yeah, so that's the first episode of season two, which is like this big kind of chase. So at that point in time, you know, on that show, we were pretty much doing a lot of long take type stuff because the show, you know, the whole design of it was real time. And so we started, you know, we did that a lot in season one, but we kind of really leaned into it and just started doing more and more of like, let's, the way to really capture this real time is just to not cut and to
and say it's real time.
Exactly. Yeah. Make it feel, just feel that we started to really get into the idea of the tension that you're creating by, and so a lot of times we're hiding cuts and everything. Sure. It was less about making it necessarily an impressive one, or and more about just making you feel like the action isn't stopping. So in the case of that one, I mean, that's a oneer that was literally shot over the course of the entire season over the entire shoot. I mean, we would shoot parts of it in one place, and you know, there was so many elements to it, because at one point they get on a guy jumps on a car, and then we take, you know, and then it, so we're merging practical shots with visual effects shots. And
so you mean during different episodes, you knew there was an asterisk and we're going to pick up this chasing shot in this alley that goes to that episode?
I mean, well, it was more like the season, basically the, you know, the whole design of it was me directing, and then Abram Cox was the other director hired. Mm-hmm. And so we basically, I would be shooting every day of the schedule, and he'd be shooting a bunch of those days, running multiple units. And so we cross-boarded the entire season. Cross-boarding meaning we wouldn't shoot one episode and one, two, three, four.
Right, bits were used for everything every day.
We'd schedule them all throughout the schedule because we knew it was just us doing it. That made it, and then we had our, you know, DPs. We had two DPs, but one main one, Yaron Levy, and then...
It's a pretty good way to control the narrative with executives, too.
For sure. You know,
they're the only ones who know what's going on. Yeah. We know all the connective tissue. Stay away, please.
I mean, at I'm that sure time, that was, that was Netflix, and they, you know, at that time, you know, I know in the last couple of years, maybe it's a sort of new kind of executives there in some places, so I can't speak to that, but when we were there... They were just incredibly supportive. It wasn't a normal executive experience.
Right. They were up for it.
That's great. They were up for it. I mean, I remember the first week of shooting the first episode of the whole thing. I remember doing it the way I was doing it, which is no coverage. And I thought, well, they're either going to send me an email or fire me day two or day three. And that email and that call never came. And so we just kept doing it. And but in the end, they liked it. They wanted it.
How could they not? It was so good. So good.
John is probably one of the reasons I'm actually making the film, actually. He doesn't know that. But like everybody I reached out to is like, don't use your own money. Don't use your own money. Don't use your money. And I said, look, John, I'm doing what everyone tells me not to do. I'm using my own money. He's like, fuck that. Use your own money. Make the fucking movie. You know how many people sit there with a script? And he wrote me this whole text about why I should do it and why it's a good idea nowadays. Like, and I was like, John, like, he made me feel good, and it kind of gave me a little kick in my ass to, like, you know what, he's right, you know?
I totally agree, and it's funny that it took Mel Gibson probably to spin the heads of a lot of people, where, yes, he had the financial resources, and they were very deep pockets, but he also knew he was spending a lot of money, but he looked around, and, I mean, his motivations probably came from a few different places, but I think probably every studio just sat there dumbfounded because the film's made so much money. Mm-hmm. He had absolute freedom, and the confidence he had was through the roof, and there was already a built-in audience. So by not answering the financiers, he mm-hmm. was independent. He was an independent voice, but he also knew the studio, what a studio film should deliver. And I think especially if someone's able to raise the money or have it, and you've got a vision, it's probably only worth doing if an executive doesn't understand it. It means you have something different that's worth taking a chance on. Yeah. And if you're not going to lose your ass.
Well, I am.
That's all the more motivation to get it right.
You don't need these middleman distributors anymore. They don't do anything. All they do is acquire your finished movie and then make a deal with a streamer or whatever
and
distributor.
Keep cutting up the pie.
Right, but then mm-hmm. they control everything. They're the only ones who know how well it's doing. They're never going to tell you the truth.
Of course.
So if you don't need them, and then you could even distribute yourself. I don't necessarily recommend that yet. I think we're getting there. Depends how big of a platform you have and how big of an audience, because everyone's also going to steal it as soon as you have a digital file of it.
Yeah,
it's gone.
Of course.
So, but if you can go directly to, I don't know where your movie will be best for, but let's just say Shutter, for lack of a, just because they're a horror one. If they're buying it directly from you, that's your recoupment,
Investors in recoupment. It goes directly to us investors. So ratheruggedmovie@gmail.com, hit me up. But that was so shameless.
I think the most important thing about that, and anyone who's thinking about doing their own thing, is if you're accepting funds, and there's nothing wrong with that path. Some people are made to serve. But if you're making your own thing and you have to compromise on a few points and the film doesn't do as well, you'll never know, was it those few compromising things that sunk it to a level that's lower than you expected? And if you know what I mean? So you don't have but if it's totally your voice and it pops through, people are like, that's fresh, that's different. What? That's a weird brain, but I love it. Yeah. You know that you have something to say and add to that community in that scene. And I think that's so important because you need so much confidence in making a film. If that could be reinforced by a success and you know it's your own, I think that's huge.
Real quick. You guys never met, so John Hyams is a phenomenal director, and this is Gabe Bartalos. He's a makeup artist for decades. He worked from the stuff I love, Basket Case, Frankenhooker, Brain Damage. He's the makeup guy that did Leprechaun, but he did tons of other big Dark Man. But he was on Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2, all of that shit. So, and he's,
well, that's what I wanted when I was a kid, that's what I wanted to be, was a makeup artist.
Right on.
I wanted, my hero was Dick Smith,
right on.
Michael Westmore, all mm-hmm. these guys. And I, that's all I wanted. You know, my dad made movies and I would hang out, you know, you'd spend time on set. I would hang out in the makeup trailer, especially watching the effects work being made. So when my brothers and I were making our little movies as kids, that was always the thing. Okay, appliances and, you mm-hmm. know, liquid latex and foam latex.
That's
great. Now, of course, it's gotten so much better with the silicone. Yeah. So I say it's, you know, the only department that I maybe annoy on my movies is the makeup department.
Thing is, you're getting close.
Yeah, because I'm always like, okay, no, what? We need more, you know, it's mm-hmm. always more blood, right?
Yeah, more blood.
And
yeah.
and it's just because they, you know, they come out and it's like, okay, they bring the actor to set and like, let's see how he's looking. I understand, as they always tell me, we can always add, we can't take mm-hmm. away. So I get it. They come out and there's that little painted line here. I'm like, no, man, come on. Put it in his mouth, have him drool it out. Let's add to this.
Well, it's interesting and I think that's cool. And maybe one of the reasons you see them side by side is, in a weird way, I actually think when makeup effects are done correctly, it's a metaphor for the whole film. Because if it's a prosthetic character, you're creating another actor, and an actor is paramount to the director and the performance. So if literally what you've applied and colored is there in motion, it's not like a lot of other departments that they're most successful if they're invisible.
Yeah.
This is, you're stepping it on center stage and you want it to be celebrated. And at the same time, you know, I do a lot of artwork on my own. I love sculpting and I'll do personal pieces. But when I'm asked to join a film, my gig is to serve the film and make it so it just inserts perfectly. And like all the Matthew Barney films, the art films, the Cream Master films.
He did all of those.
You did the Cream Master?
Yeah. And all of those was like completely changing my brain. And, you know.
The face that he had.
Exactly. The Lawton candidate. Yeah. So, and a lot of that was like, right. And Matthew was coming to me for you. I want you, Gabe. But then I'm like, well, wait a minute. I have to shut parts of me off and serve this now very bizarre shoot we got going on. And it's wonderful when you're asked back, which A is an ultimate compliment, but you start to get a shorthand with the filmmakers and you notice their shoes, you notice what they're listening to, you channel that all into the effects. Yeah. So it appeals to him and his sensibility and thus the project, you know? And So it would make sense if you're passionate about the films. I could see that right in the sidecar makeup effects.
Hey, yes.
I know you got to break at noon. I got one more question for you.
Okay.
Because we were talking about Texas Chainsaw 2 before. I said, save it for that. So he worked on Chainsaw 2 and you started telling the story about, can we talk about Texas Chainsaw Massacre Part 2 before you leave? Do we got time for that? And then I'll let you leave.
That was the first movie that I ever saw through like a home stereo system. And so because I was too young to see it in the theater, and it was a friend's birthday party, sleepover or whatever, but his parents had their VCR connected to all these speakers in the room. So it started loud and stuff, but that scene with Mosley and Caroline Williams standing in front of the vault with the dark. And then the chainsaw comes. And like he never starts the chainsaw. Yeah. So I'm not just running. I've never been so fucking scared. Like that jump scare was so great. And I still, to this day, like, whenever I have it on, if there's anyone else in the house, come here, watch this. Like, Just watch.
You know it's going to get him, right?
Yeah, it gets him every time.
I'll tell you my disappointing Chainsaw. I love Chainsaw 2 now, a lot of it. I don't love the whole film, but they made it unrated, or they made it NC-17 or something, right? Or it wasn't R-rated. So I went to see it with my stepfather, and at this time it was the middle 80s, so all kids saw horror, gore. We've seen everything already, right? And for some reason, they picked that movie to be NC-17, no kid under 17. So we went there, and we went to buy tickets to see Chainsaw Massacre 2. And I was like 11 or 12, and he said, no kids at all. And I'm like, yeah, I'm with my stepfather. What are you talking about? And they wouldn't let my stepfather buy tickets to see the fucking thing. Mm. So I'm like, I wonder what the fuck is in this movie. You know, got to be crazy.
And there was nothing
in it. So we went to the theater up the block, and he bought for like an R-rated, whatever. He bought tickets for something else, and we went to see Chainsaw Massacre 2. I was like, oh, it's kind of regular, you know, Fangoria horror type of shit. So because of that, it fucked it up for me the first time I seen it, because I was waiting for something that was supposed to fuck my brain up, and it was kind of, you know, ordinary horror, you know. Mm-hmm.
So. Do you know the story, what happened with Hatchet 2? With Hatchet 1, the MPAA tore it to shreds before the theatrical, so like nothing good was in it. Even like I think the face rip, it like cut away or something.
Wow.
There were full deaths that were like lifted from it. They killed it. So with the second one, it was supposed to go straight to video and I could do whatever I wanted. So I went way bigger. And then all of a sudden the distributor is like, good news, AMC just started this thing called AMC Independent. We're going to put it in without a rating. First time since Romero's Dawn of the Dead that a movie's going to play in major multiplexes without a rating. And I was like, we did it. So that was their whole marketing campaign. The trailer, everything was just like unrated gore like you've never seen. So then 3 days before the release, we're doing press. And all of a sudden there has to be a representative from AMC on the phone and the publicist for the distributor, and they're like, do not mention the rating, don't talk about it anymore, it's going to cause a problem. But that was their whole marketing campaign. Well, you know, they bank interviews, so I had already done one with Entertainment Weekly 3 weeks earlier, and then that ran the day the movie came out, and it's me with a picture of duct tape over my mouth, and the headline says, Adam Green calls the MPAA evil. So the movie came out on Thursday night at midnight, by Saturday morning, pulled from all screens, gone. Wow. So now people are like, I have to fucking see this thing. Mm-hmm. And there's nothing that, like, it's just like a slasher movie. Like, it's gory, but there's nothing offensive in it.
The expectations got too
high.
So I was like, this is going to kill it. I mean, thankfully, you know, we just did part four, like whatever that was, a few years ago. So it's still going. Wow. But to get pulled from theaters and not be allowed to talk about it, because my lawyers are like... don't die on this hill. You're going to go on to make other movies. You're going to need to work with, like, you don't want to be a marked person with them. Yeah. But fuck fuck the MPAA. Seriously. They're useless now. They can't really do any more harm. So yeah. Fuck you.
And all I right. Go so, on that hey, note, thanks so much for your time, man.
Yeah, man. Great to see you. Great to meet you. Yeah,
make some noise really for Adam yes. Green.
Good to see you again.
Good to see you. Longer. Yes.
You know, we didn't get to talk about digging up marrow, man.
Are you talking about it by
my yeah, mind? Yeah. It sucks. No, it doesn't suck. It's a good one. No, it's a good film.
Thank you.
Send my regards to Joe.
I will. I'm going to see him tonight.
All right.
I was meant to, you know, we just talking and talking. I forgot to bring it up. It's a film I like, actually. But, yeah, thanks. Give me a text or call me, man.
I will.
Thanks for your time. All right, how's the shot look now? We got
my chair missing. Must we rearrange here? How are we doing?
Yeah,
okay, Adam's leaving. It's time to bring in the strippers. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Hey, thanks for coming,
no
man.
Problem.
It's awesome.
You want to get in the center? Are you good there?
No, it's fine. It's fine. He's on his director. He's like, shouldn't you be? I was like, my shit is messy. We're just being messy with it. So yeah, yeah, yeah. But actually, you know what's funny is the way I met him, because I was such a fan of the Universal Soldier film, Twitter. You know, you hit a, hey, great, great movie. And turns out, I think, was it you or your brother, or both of you, or just your brother was a rapper, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so he's like, yo, actually, my brother's
brother,
a rapper. And we went to, you know, your show, or somebody, there was something, his brother was a fan of mine.
Mm-hmm.
And then so we just stayed in touch, and, you know, I was trying to get him to do a video back, this was probably 50, when was Day of Reckoning?
It was 2012.
So about 12 years ago, yeah. You know, I was like, hey, you know. But you know, he's always working. The guy's always working.
Yeah, no, I would have loved it. I'd love to do a video. I never got to really break into the music video thing so much. Yeah. But that would always be, you know, and it's probably like the budgets and everything are different these days. Yeah. I don't know. But you got some good videos going.
Yeah, I got lucky. I got a lot. My guy Jonas in Belgium, he's a monster. He did a film called Hazard. And he did a movie called Cub, but with the music videos, he makes my videos look like money. Like he brings out his people, and he did the legendary Loser video that's on the
Good
Biology
one.
Blu-ray. Mm-hmm. He did a couple others too. He's really, really good. But I got a whole good team of video directors. But yeah, I would have loved to get you to do one because I wanted an action one. I said, let's do an action one. But if you look at his damn IMDb page, the guy's working like fucking mm-hmm.
you gotta stay busy. I mean, it's a hustle for all of us, you know. It's not you're always just trying to, you know. So for me, fortunately, episodic TV has been able to, you know, keep the basically pay the bills, and really it's been able to allow me to not, I always never wanted to be in a position where I had to do a movie that I didn't love. And there was a time around there in the, you know, 2013 or so where, you know, I was getting pretty close to saying yes to something. You read the script or something, you're like, well, I could probably make something of this. But
that's hard, though, if you're not 100%.
It's dangerous. Yeah. And so then suddenly once I was able to get the TV work going again, suddenly it's like, okay, I can do this. And if I don't get a movie going this year, then I don't get one going this year, but at least I'm not making one.
Mm-hmm.
Because once you do it, then you're in, and that's a year plus of your life. And
you've already eroded your soul a little.
Well, yeah. You're all in, and not only are you all in, you have to, when it's done, then you have to go represent it. And there's really nothing in there. You can, you know, there's all sorts of things that can go sideways in a movie, or executives or whatnot, or the MPAA or something that can screw it up, and still it's on you. Yeah. You got to wear it all.
Yeah.
And you have to go out and represent it. I don't think you really, I never want to be in a position of saying, this is not really the one I intended to make.
Yeah. And worse. And if you don't say it, means you're not putting your real face forward.
Right.
Yeah. But you know, with the episodic television, what is probably super interesting is it allows for tons of ideas to be exercised. So in a sense, you might like, I've only done a couple music videos as a director. And what I found that I really liked was it was a punk band called The Briggs. They got signed to Side One Dummy. So there was a little money going around, and they were picking people that they saw with cool ideas and visions. And so I said, yeah, I want to shoot it in film, and I'm going to you got to just give yourself over to me. So in the back of my studio, we set up giant rain towers, and I built really elaborate wooden bizarro sets, and just put them through the works. And the idea was, though, it was so rapid fire with the beat of it, I was able to put in just hundreds of ideas that were rapid fire with the editorial. And it was really satisfying. Because
continuity on a music video, that's the great thing about music videos. Yes. You don't got to worry about nothing.
Yeah.
Because it just
if you're moving past, you know, the synchronization. But what was the duality of it was, whether you're shooting in film or not, is it's you're a little bit like, you know, if I were letting these takes go with all the setups, you'd have almost a feature film if you're really trying to make each shot its own thing. But on the flip side, those who care see a really compact 3-minute, 42-second rapid fire thing where you get to download your brain a little bit and get all these ideas out of there into one succinct high energy piece.
Well, and what you're saying, which is absolutely true, and some people have this in commercials, some people have it in music videos. For me, it's episodic, is you get to workshop ideas. You get to basically practice stuff, you know? Mm. And so I've done a lot of things on episodes of TV, like, well, let's try this. And in some cases, you're like, it wasn't the greatest idea, but we tried it, you know?
But then you may nurture it. You may go, hey, I got something. Let's take it to the next level. It incubates.
What was your earliest memory on a set? Because I know you came from a family with filmmakers. Did they put you on the sets, or were you kind of like set home and not on the sets?
No, I grew up, my older brother and I grew up on the sets, you know? So my dad was a director, and
Peter Hyams,
fantastic director.
Great director.
And and I learned everything from him, and he was very open with us. So it was, you know, some people like being on a set. Some people are bored being on a set. You know, I'm one of those people who I couldn't get enough of it. So I could just, you know, the only rule was don't talk, don't make any noise, don't bother anybody. If you can be quiet and just sit there, then you can be there. And so the first time I remember, I mean, I think I've been on a set even younger, but my earliest memories are probably 6 years old on the set of this movie he made called Capricorn One, being out.
He's a fan.
I bow to that film.
Yeah, I mean, I love that.
I was going to ask you about that because...
Yes, I remember it well.
How old were you then?
I was 6, I think.
Wow.
And being in the Mojave Desert, we were doing that whole big desert stuff. Yeah. The helicopters and all the guys going through. And that was where Michael Westmore was the makeup artist on that. Wow. And the guys, they're supposed to be out in the desert.
Their lips are splitting.
Chapped lips and blisters. And he had made all this. And he gave me, at the end of the shoot, the big plaster molds of the lips and the blisters.
Wow.
So for every, you know, for every Halloween, I had like chapped lips and blisters.
That's great. Wow.
And so I remember being, you know, on that set. I remember, you know, one of the famous sequences in that movie is this chase between two helicopters and a biplane, an aerial.
Telly Savalas is piloting it. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah. Elliot Gould and Telly Savalas are there. James Brolin is his stunt double. Is hanging on the wing, and then these two helicopters are chasing him through the desert. And what made it such a, and I learned everything from my dad. Especially about action filmmaking, because he was very much into how do you create momentum? How do you make the camera move at the speed that the characters are moving? So if he did a car chase, it was never about the camera's here and the cars drive by. It was like the camera's got to be moving with the vehicle.
Yeah, that going on the hills in San Francisco there. It's in the car. It's bolted to the car.
That's right.
It's you get those whoom. Yes. That's some of the first times I felt in the theater my stomach go up and down.
Oh, so you saw it theatrically as a kid? Oh,
I know every frame of that film. It's one of the few that...
That's funny.
To
I didn't
interject
know that.
Is if I was a film teacher, I would put that film front and center because tonally it if nothing else, a director's job is to have an umbrella of the tone of the film. And especially that film where there's comedic elements, high energy, even political conspiracy stuff that echoes with relevance, which to me means smart. It's all in that film. And to juggle that, if anyone's made a film, that's the difficulty. And it's done so well. And it again, every choice is proper. A director blows it sometimes by making the wrong choice. And I have a few laser discs left, and the front and center one that is on display is Capricorn.
Wow, 1. I didn't even know that.
I want people to say, I remember that or what, and I'll go, it's important. You should watch this film.
Six years old, he was sitting right
there. Well, that's amazing.
I mean, that's amazing.
And that's wonderful that it influenced people like you. And that's amazing, and my dad would love to hear that. And so here's an interesting point, is that my earliest memory was we'd be back at wherever base camp is, and the helicopters have landed, and they're about to take off for another take. And the way they shot that, right now we have drones, or we used to, you know, with helicopter photography, you'd have like what's called a West Cam, different rigs. Mm-hmm. Back then, the way they shot that sequence was they had the plane and the helicopters. Then they had a follow helicopter that mm-hmm. was going to, and my dad shot it. And what they did was they literally took
pulled the door off.
They didn't pull the door off. Well, I mean, the door may have been off. Mm-hmm. They had a chair bolted to the outside of the helicopter.
And he was operating?
And he's strapped into the chair holding a camera. Right, so he's just sitting outside mm-hmm. of that. So I remember seeing my dad get in the chair.
Have you seen these rigs?
I went up in one.
The door is removed. And it's, I don't know what it telescopes into. It clicks in, but it almost looks like a one of the dolly chairs comes pivoting out. And the cameraman is literally, he's harnessed in. And I was producing a film where I'm next to the camera guy. And, you know, a lot of faith in the webbing there. But the camera operator is hanging out there. So he was actually manning the camera.
Well, what you're talking about is even, like, a better version of it.
Mm-hmm.
His was before they had even, like...
Yeah, this was the 2000s. So we had probably a comfort. So no, this was raw.
I mean, this is literally just a chair attached to the outside helicopter. And he's in it.
Fantastic.
There's nothing else figured out. And he's got a camera in his hand that is essentially handheld and probably like strapped to him by some cable.
Yeah. Or some safety on it. Yeah.
Yeah. And that was it. And fantastic. And I remember watching him just take off in the helicopter.
I hope you come back, Dad.
A couple of helicopters and a plane, and then him taking off and me thinking, that's like the coolest shit I've ever seen in my life. I want to do that. Like,
I mean,
what a job.
So was that the moment?
I think that was one of a bunch of moments, but that was, I have vivid memories of a lot of the, and again, that Mojave stuff was maybe just a handful of weeks or whatever mm-hmm. it was, but that we were there and I remember them setting up, you know, the guy, you know, James Brolin's character jumping through the window and setting up
the gas station,
all that stuff. But the funny thing is I rewatched that movie. We went to the Oldenburg Film Festival, did a tribute to my dad, I guess father and son thing, and they did a tribute to him.
There's
an Oldenburg Film Festival out in Germany.
Oldenburg is in Germany?
Yeah, okay. It's in Germany, and they do this cool like festival out there. And this was not this year's, but last year's. And so I went, we showed like a handful of my movies and showed a bunch of his, and I introduced his and was rewatching not just Capricorn 1, but all his movies, and realized when I was watching it that like, oh, I've stolen all my moves from him. Mm-hmm. I got everything from
him.
Everything that I'm doing, I took from something here.
Yeah, it's so cool, though. I mean, that's the best way to pass the baton, and that you acknowledge it. You know?
Oh, it's obvious. Yeah, and it's like, but I'd even forgotten some of the things, and I'd watch like that shot of James Brolin in the gas station. He's searching around, out the window, you see the helicopters.
Yeah, they turned him into characters. There's a bit where the helicopters actually turn to one another. So he was communicating that they're their own entities. They're talking. It's like there's little stuff like that where you're like, I see what's happening here. And, you know, back to what you guys were talking about before, films that made you cry or something. I didn't cry, but it's incredibly impactful, the mom reading at the point where she thinks her husband is dead. And you're internalizing... She still has to go on being a mom. She has to distill this information. How do you do it? When all of that stuff in that performance is there.
Yeah.
And
Vaccaro.
Yeah, it's just strong stuff all over the place. Even when he goes to the apartment and they've swapped it out and the lady's got the rubber glove and she's like, huh? And Ellie goes like, no way. And he's running around getting this stuff.
That, by the way, her reading the story, I think she's reading Dr. Seuss, I believe.
Yeah.
And it's that's my older brother. Oh, really? He's Charles Brubaker Jr.
Fantastic.
So my older brother got the mm-hmm. you know, got his SAG card there. He's
right on.
Gone on to way other things.
And all right, like, it ends.
He's an actor now.
No, my brother is the CEO of Indeed. You know, the like the job search site. He's okay. He went into tech.
So it's better than being an entertainer. Cause
it's way better. Yeah. But he has the brains for it. I couldn't do what he did.
And when he gets residuals from Capricorn One, they probably go, why does this name keep appearing? Gabe Bartalos over and over.
That's the difference. You know? Is my brother could do what I do, but I could not do what he does.
And the film ends with a freeze frame. Yeah. It's like fantastic of him running toward the graveyard, like Invasion of Body Snatchers. Like every good movie needs to just end on that grainy freeze frame.
And you can't also like underestimate the Jerry Goldsmith score.
Yeah, it's amazing.
That movie is just like the bat. You know, I mean, music is obviously so critical, mm-hmm. but that when you had guys like Jerry Goldsmith and that, the music in that movie is such a big part of it.
Well, he earns his paycheck all through it, but the moment where there's the zenith to me is where the voiceover and we're the president talking and we're proud and you see it's a movie set. Yeah. And the way the music, it's an uncut shot of they pan from the moonscape, Marscape 2, you suddenly see the movie lights.
Yes.
And that we're proud of you. And the narrative actually goes against of like you're the truth and you see it's a facade. And the way the music builds to timing when those images come on, it's so strong, it's so good.
And the key in that shot, right, it's just the two guys,
the
silhouetted, stand like in suits,
the heavies, Hal Holbrook-ish,
he's just like, oh, these are the G-men that are here.
I guess it's, you know, it might be a question more for your father, but to take, do you think that's representative of distrust of the times of thing, like did he have his finger on the pulse of his, do you think it just came from sheer creativity to think of something wild like that, or was there like, man, there's some nasty stuff at work behind the scenes, not that there's a star chamber or something, but maybe that there's more to reality than we know.
I think that that movie is clearly a post-Watergate movie,
mm-hmm.
right? So you had movies like Parallax View. Mm-hmm. You know, Parallax View is a classic. Alan Pakula. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's a classic paranoid thriller.
Yeah.
And so
maybe that's it.
Though. Capricorn One. Because if you ask my dad, like, you know, do you think they faked the moon landing? He'd say, no, of course they didn't. Mm-hmm. But, you know, that would be his. But he loved the idea of, and he was a reporter.
Mm-hmm.
So he started out as a reporter.
Really?
Yes. So that was his.
So his gig was to dig.
Yeah.
So that's what he's doing. He's not taking a stance either way or trying to open a can of worms. It's just like, hey, if you spun this Rubik's Cube one more time, you got a cool story.
Well, and it's like as a reporter, his heroes were obviously Woodward and Bernstein. Two reporters, if you take all the President's Men, the movie they made of it, but the real story, two reporters brought down the government, brought down the president. Yeah. So in Capricorn One, the hero of the story is the reporter, Elliot Gould, who's like, everyone thinks he's an asshole and his boss thinks he's an asshole. And he's kind of like this, he's kind of almost like the Philip Marlowe character of the movie. So I think it was in many ways sort of his love letter to the journalist.
Detective journalism.
Yeah, the detective, investigative
journalist.
But that was in the air then, right? The paranoid thriller, the government had already proven it was lying and doing a bunch of shady shit.
Well, that was also the 70s where you could get away with, you know, fuck America, fuck this, fuck government, fuck, you know, in the 50s you could have a little paranoia, you know, but I think the 70s was a free
for all to do whatever and going on, Watergate, you know, so all that stuff. Of course.
Right, and being a reporter, it was probably unavoidable for him to take all that in.
Yeah.
That makes a lot of sense.
So, yeah, I think it's, so he loves that kind of stuff. And I think he really admired those Pakula movies. You know, those are great movies.
Pakula's a great director.
Pakula's a guy that not a lot of people, I mean,
Clute.
He's one that doesn't get talked about enough. Pakula was really a masterful director.
His movies
had just a tone and a vibe and the Gordon Willis photography. It was
Gordon
really,
Willis. That's, you know, he's one of the most famous cinematographers ever. And we were talking about Woody Allen the other day and when he learned how to go from comedy to drama, and he said it's when he was with Gordon Willis.
That's right.
And yesterday I was in the car and I'm like, the guy that did the cinematography for Godfather, the guy, and I couldn't think of his fucking name. And then you just said, yeah, Gordon Willis.
Well, that's it. And Woody Allen went from his movies looking, you know, bananas, which are great
and Sleeper, they were fun comedies. Funny,
but then suddenly Annie Hall, the first, but you look at Manhattan, like, this is a sophisticated looking movie. That suddenly changed.
Right, what got inserted into this formula suddenly.
You guys seen Zelig, right?
Mm-hmm. Brilliant. Yeah, one of the greatest.
Before Forrest Gump did all of that, mm-hmm. that was Zelig. Yeah,
again,
yeah.
And that was Gordon Willis as well. So it really shows the importance of what a cinematographer and it brings to mm-hmm. a production and to just a film. And sometimes it's that partnership. It's the partnership. But in that case, when Woody Allen partnered with Gordon Willis, it took him to a totally next level.
Because Zelig, they made it like it was a real documentary. Mm-hmm. So I think Woody was saying sometimes they put the film in the shower or was doing everything to try to make certain clips look.
They were beating it up. Yeah.
Yeah. And
I read a great interview on that point about a DP that Roman Polanski said in his early films, whenever he'd see the dailies, he was like, yeah. And he wasn't saying anything. Maybe he was getting his chops, but he said, something's wrong. Something's wrong, you know? And literally 2-3 movies, he's like, yeah, yeah. And then he got a new DP who was his height. And he said he realized he's disproportionately small. Wow. All the DPs were average or tall. So when he's like this and put a 55 on, got it, boss. But he's like, it's not what I'm seeing.
That's amazing.
And it took a DP of his same height that finally he's seeing the dailies of, that's what I see through my eyepiece.
Wow.
Like, or, you know, his viewfinder. Wow.
It's so funny.
Isn't that bizarre? That
Was Helen Mirren in 2010?
Yeah.
Okay, so it is the right movie. She told a funny story about your father, because was your father grandparents Russian Jews or something?
Yeah.
Okay, so there's a story. Okay, right people. So she said that he wanted her to play a Russian, this and that. So she learned how to speak Russian. She hung out with Russians and this and that. And she came in and your father was like, no, that's not how they talk, you know? And she realized that she learned the Russian from people in England. And it was this thing. And he grew up with Russian New York Jewish and was used to that Russian. So she relearned that way to talk. And he was like, yeah, perfect. So, something like that. It's not the exact story, but
yeah, but that's true. Yeah, his grandpa was a... kind of, he was like the show business roots of our family, basically. Yeah, yeah. My dad's grandpa, my great grandpa, was a guy named Saul Hurok, who basically brought the Russian ballet to America.
Wow.
So he was an impresario, basically. Wow. So he came from Ukraine, and then when he emigrated to America, and then he brought all these famous, you know, ballet dancers, helped them defect from Russia, Nureyev and all these, mm-hmm. all these, you know, big time people.
That's a gateway. Mm-hmm.
And so, my dad grew up with that, you know, with that being, I guess that again, like that was kind of his introduction to show business.
Wow.
And
wow.
So,
how do you go from seeing that as a day-to-day stuff? And when you internalize it, is it, do you get spooked or excited to take the leap to say, I want to follow that path?
Well, you know, interesting. I started out probably with your background. I was in the studio arts, mm-hmm. so I was always, you know, a drawer and a painter, mm-hmm. and then ended up studying that and then going to art school and art university for that. So I was a painter and a sculptor, always knowing that I loved movies. But the interesting thing is that I had an older brother. My older brother. You know, the older brother gets the camera, right? So then he's like, I'm the director. So you can't have two directors.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why.
There's only one Super 8 camera in the family.
That's right. There's only one camera. Yeah. So I didn't question that. So I was like, okay, I'd be the actor in our movies. And I use a very loose term when I say actor. Mm-hmm. But like all of our movies were like one guy chasing another guy. And then eventually they have a fight. You know, right. That was pretty much every
movie. And a dummy flies through.
Yeah, exactly. So we would make these. And so I would said, oh, I'll be the makeup artist. So I was into the studio arts. And And I always kind of had it in the back of my mind, well, I'd love to do film one day, but this is the thing I'm good at. Yeah. And this is what I've invested all this time and energy in. And at a certain point in time, which kind of goes back to what you were saying, I've started, you know, I was living in New York, all my friends out of college, and I was actually making a living selling artwork and doing that. And then I worked as a fabricator for other mm-hmm. artists for years, for 10 years before I really made film. But I would take my own money and finance, you know, film shoots where we would shoot, you know.
Right, so it was really in there. It was bubbling up at that point.
It was self-financed.
It was self-financed, and it started out. It was maybe going to be just a short or do some scenes, and then I kept putting more money into it, more and more. Oh, we'll make a feature out of this.
Time, and
getting my friends on the weekends and when they could do it, and then at a certain point, I'd spent all my money. I'm in huge debt. And I kind of have to now make what am I going to do?
Did you shoot in 16?
16 black and white.
Nice.
And then it was, you know, when it showed at some festivals and things. But it was at that point where I'm like, well, am I going to go back? I went back to the artwork and back to the fabricating work. And then I decided I can't do film or this work casually. I got to make a choice.
Yeah.
And I just decided, even though it's like, there's nothing less romantic than an out of work filmmaker. Like being an out of work artist, there's a little bit of romance there. Right. But just
you can at least wear a beret or something.
Yeah, at least you're going to making paintings every day, and you're like, hey, come look at my paintings. When you're like a filmmaker with no movie, like you're one of a lot of people. But I said, I'm going to do it. You know, I think I have to just go full bore into this. And so, you know, I was practically 30, I was almost 30 when I made that choice. I was over 30 before I even got to do my first thing, which was a documentary at the time. And that was just because...
Oh, what was it called again?
It's called The Smashing Machine.
Okay.
Which is actually on that
kickboxing?
Yeah, it was on Mark Kerr, the fighter.
Dude, it's incredible. Do you know this film? Unbelievable. Yeah. Okay, yeah. Pedigree. That film, okay, I'm not a UFC boxing kind of thing.
Yeah.
Because one could say it's not about that. It's a social study profile of, I guess the dangers of when he gets sloppy and he's drinking 2 to 3 weeks out before a meet. He's an unstoppable, is it UFC kickboxing?
Yeah, it was back then. So UFC was MMA. But basically they were fighting in Japan.
So well made.
Oh, thank you.
And the stolen shots where the camera's hidden on the bookcase and she flips them off and stuff.
Yeah.
It's like, what's so interesting is the subject, this boxer, kickfighter dude, when he says that why he's winning so much is that he's afraid. He wants to get it over with. And he's a monster and he kicks everyone's ass in the ring. But it's such an interesting duality that he's afraid. He wants it to end. He wants out of that ring. And that dimension...
Yeah.
You know, whether it's narratively pushed or a real thread is so interesting as a viewer. You're like, wow, I'm looking at this guy now. I'm learning so much about this person. And as the rise happens, while the documentary is happening, the fall happens.
Yep.
And listening to the behind the scenes, I was like, that's unbelievable.
So you didn't even know that was him?
No idea. Yeah. It's just one of those, like, I have all these movies I love and people would be like, why is a movie? I'm like, that one is really good. Awesome. I don't care about the kickboxing. It's a well-made film. Mm-hmm. And it was amazing that I think you described in there that, we're ghosting him for 2-3 years. And I think it was substance abuse. He started indulging too much. He started to break his workout protocol. And when he finally loses that first time, seeing his tears and his heartbreak, it's heavy. It's everything you want the audience to feel I got. I was like, wow, man, I am there. Cool. Lifetime of this descent.
I'm glad I asked him what the movie was called. Well, I didn't know.
It's interesting because, you know, I had never had any intention of doing documentaries, but that was the only thing I could get going at the time. So, you know, we set out basically to make Pumping Iron.
Mm-hmm.
But what we ended up getting was more Raging Bull.
Not necessarily
in his personality type, but in
the arc.
It was more about the internal thing going on with this guy outside of the ring. Mm-hmm. Interestingly enough, that they are now Benny Safdie is making that movie with The Rock.
Oh, really?
Dwayne Johnson. They're doing like they based got on, they got the rights.
What was the guy's name? The boxer?
Mark Kerr.
Mark Kerr. Okay.
Yeah.
Was he famous in that world?
In that world, he was. But the interesting thing about that was because now we're talking late 90s, early 2000s MMA. It wasn't even called MMA then. They called it extreme fighting, ultimate fighting, all different ultimate things.
So it was the UFC then.
Okay. Well, there was the UFC was around, but then the UFC got banned in all.
Oh, when almost, they were doing different weight classes and all of that?
Well, what really happened was they had promoted it as like this blood and guts kind of thing.
There's the brutality escalated.
And then certain like politicians, John McCain being McCain was against it. He was, a bunch of the politicians got against it. So they started outlawing it in all these states. Mm-hmm. This is before Dana White took over.
And this was when like 550-pound guys would fight 120-pound guy.
They it was just about whoever, the spectacle. And
they had no weight class. Yeah. It was really created as a like...
Gladiator warrior.
Well, it was actually created as a showcase for Gracie Jiu-Jitsu. One of the Gracies was one of the guys who created it, and the Gracies had been doing these kind of tournaments in Brazil for years.
Yeah.
Anyway, not to go down the too much of a tangent, but the bottom
people
line,
people like, but knowledge, it
was
you know?
The interesting thing was that it had been outlawed in so many states here that all the fighters, all the money was in Japan. Because in Japan, where this is like warrior culture, they celebrated fighting. And so you had all these guys that were sort of these athletes who are unknown in their own country.
Mm-hmm.
But they go to Japan and they're in the Tokyo Dome.
And
everyone loves them. So that was, at that time, that's where all the money was there. And it really wasn't until Dana White and those guys bought the UFC, figured out how to promote it right, worked with the commissions that they were able to create MMA as we know it, where it's like a legitimate sport back then. But it was an interesting time too, because all those guys who were competing had been they were something before this sport was created. So like Mark Curry, he was a freestyle wrestler. Mm-hmm. And then you had like a karate guy.
Or
had
sumo.
They all started.
So it was all these different like disciplines going against each other. And
did you have a fight?
No.
Oh, I don't know, because he's a master at fight sequences. Like his fight sequences are like your fight sequences.
I appreciate that, not like some
of the best I've seen. So
I appreciate that, and it's more. You know, that's more. I credit my dad with that.
Oh, from watching him as a kid.
It's just watching how to shoot action, how to cover action, and what is, you know, and to me, like when I went into that movie. And again, I think that's my role as a director is I didn't know anything about fighting, but some of the producers, some of the guys that I worked with.
Crazy, because your fighting is like...
That's another one. You made every right decision between the editorial and, you know, documentaries, Herbs. You're just rolling. You're rolling and rolling. And that's where it comes down to having an overview of the narrative and making those decisions with a good editor, because it's all done correctly.
Yeah,
and I think if people ever have to wade through footage that they shot in a documentary, I think it's amplified. If you're doing a narrative film, you know the 17 frames you're pulling out usually. You know there's fat on both sides and you're going for that, especially with effects. You know, you want that moment. With documentary stuff, a lot of it could be great. And that's where almost the most important part, again, for a director, the overview.
Well, you're right.
The giant cloak.
You're basically writing the script in the editing room. And that's, I think, doing documentary helped me. That's kind of where I got my 10,000 hours, you know, just because you basically are doing dozens and dozens of
so many choices
before you come to the right version. And so many, you know, you try everything out. And to see if it's going to work, and you know, until you end up with what you end up with. And so I look at documentaries now. I love to watch documentaries, but when I look at them now, I get exhausted with the idea of like, oh my God, what they had to go, how much footage they had to
see through. Exactly. The sheer volume.
It's just like hundreds and hundreds of hours.
So you didn't come up on like exploitation and kung fu and none of that. It was mainly from watching prestigious films and your father work and because when I watch your films, I'm like, yo, he must know the whole Shaw Brothers collection. This guy, but
I think a little bit of everything, you know. But it wasn't like I'm not really a fan of one genre any other one. I think, you know, my brother and I had our own taste, so we'd watch our dad's movies. We'd watch like again. prestige movies, Scorsese, Kubrick, all that, Coppola, Friedkin, all that stuff. But then we start getting introduced to, like, Carpenter, right? So okay. John Carpenter became...
Oh, so you could nerd out with us on the horror, too?
Oh, man. Yeah, and I became a huge Carpenter, and I was so into makeup effects mm-hmm. that then I got into horror because I was interested in makeup effects. Yes. So it's like, mm-hmm. oh, Maniac, they're doing a scalping.
Oh, wow. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Shout out to William Lustig.
Yeah. Yeah. But well, I think it's Lustig, interesting yeah. if you introduce Carpenter because there's somebody who's... I don't think he was looking at it as exploitation. Like, he was making, he probably knew what he was doing.
It wasn't exploitation. I was talking more about the kung fu exploitation.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But horror Carpenter's films fall into that. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And people who maybe don't dissect the horror directors may miss that, you know, Carpenter was striving for bigger stuff. I mean, when he started getting into anamorphic lenses, he wants to make cinema. And I think... not that he's overreaching because he succeeds so many times. It's that that ambition is he's making art. He's not making product, which can be the shorthand for exploitation.
Well, and you're right. And I actually think that's the thing about Carpenter. And that's the thing that I find myself now is that he may have been, you know, my favorite thing is to take B movie ideas. Mm-hmm. Because there's something base about, mm-hmm. you know, deep, you know, genre ideas, but he could apply a real artistry to it and elevate that.
Totally.
You know, to me, that's the ultimate movie to me is Ridley Scott's Alien, because
mm-hmm. yeah.
that's could be a Roger Corman movie.
Yep.
If you just took
it
that
was,
script.
Like, which it was. Planet yeah. of Vampires yeah. with yeah. Bava's movie and yeah, exactly. yeah, yeah, the script.
But
yeah.
then taking that and without, he didn't make it more intellectual necessarily.
He just made it beautiful.
He just made it, yeah, believable beautiful, and real and visceral. And so I was like, this is what a director does. You can take the most, a monster alien takes over a ship, kills everybody. One person survives and kills him. That's yeah. it. Yeah. We don't know about his backstory, anything. Yeah. Obviously, so much respect to the script. It's brilliant, right. and it's brilliant in what it doesn't go into, you know, because you.
Yeah,
not,
I think Carpenter knew to anchor it in those archetypes.
Yeah, that's all that stuff. And so Carpenter, like Halloween, and you look at all those early movies of his, and even later movies. I mean, Christine. I think Christine yeah. is a great movie.
I love Christine as well. Yeah. I love the dialogue in Christine. Yeah. But
they're so yeah. well crafted, mm-hmm. and there's something about his sensibility,
yeah.
his sense of humor, his...
Right, the balancing act that he lands on. It's yeah, funny you say
he
Christine.
He just lands.
My 9-year-old daughter, Nova, is really into Christine.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it kind of brought me back to the film that I wouldn't rush to that one because I was looking for either... The Halloween and the Fog, because of age, it hit at the right zone and the makeup effects of the thing. But re-watching Christine over and over and over again, I'm like, it's his most confident film. Every shot moves, like, again, if that was shown in a film school, it moves the narrative forward. The performances are so good. And it has this...
All the performances are top-notch.
All of it are
man.
Great. Every one of them. Yeah, and it's the same thing. It has a comic book B to it, but again, the way he shot it and the like he dealt with it seriously, and maybe that's the difference of it. Let everyone else find whether it's camp or the B sensibilities, but he took and shot it beautifully. And it's funny, a big reawakening for that film where I'm like, wow, it's not Halloween is amazing, but he's learning his chops, and you see some cracks. The Fog, they went back and reshot like a tenth of the movie, and you could feel some of those inserts where the studio was like, "We need some more gore." Okay. You know, the thing is, its own wonderful thing.
Super confident.
Assault on Precinct 13.
Yeah, 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 exactly, exactly. So
that's my top three coffee. I think maybe. I know that's.
Well, yeah. but why I think that film is so strong was he was really fiercely independent at that point. Every step up the ladder as a director, there's a new insertion of people watching the money. So it's almost like they get knocked back a point. There's those rare moments where there's financial freedom. They leave him alone, Christine, and it's his full confident voice. Yeah, and you're like, oh, there he hit a stride.
He's not a fan of Christine either.
No, he's not.
But no, and I know he did it more just to stay busy.
Yeah,
but,
no, and director's not like in their own movie. Doesn't mean the movie's not good.
But see, that all right, this brings up a really interesting point to me.
Exactly.
I've read that and reconsidered it. Do you think there's something about then a filmmaker who really cares about what he's doing to suddenly, are you getting in your own way when you're so emotionally hanging on to every nuance? And I think about this because he was public to say the thing was a disaster. He backed away. He needed a job. He took on Christine.
He was supposed to direct Firestarter. You know that, right? And they took it away from him because
so you're
the thing
already
flopped.
Disheartened. That's a very dangerous way to say yes to a film. But now he was a working director and he was knowing the language. I wonder if that film benefited the way that we all agree it does because a hair of his passion was turned off and he just followed the great crew around him and did what he was meant to and didn't overthink stuff to where you personalize something to a fault? I don't know.
Well, I mean, you may be right. The one thing, if you've ever heard an interview with John Carpenter, which we all probably have, it's like he's probably the most no bullshit guy who's ever walked the earth.
And angry.
Yeah. But
it's so refreshingly direct.
Yeah. He doesn't, and he doesn't bullshit. He doesn't, he'll say, oh, I did this for the money. I did it. Like he's no artifice to a fault, but to a beautiful fault.
Yeah.
So I do think that when he was making, you know, a movie like that, like you say, for whatever reason, he's still, every decision that is he's making as he does that is just going to be informed by his taste and sensibility, right? Now,
which was spot on at that moment.
Exactly. Like, and there are cases of directors like, I mean, all of us, you maybe lose that meter at some point in time. Like everyone, you know, there are artistic peaks and that occurs. And it's like, I remember someone explaining it to me this way, and it makes sense. You know, once you do what you do, what I do, what you do, right? Any of these things, whether it's music, makeup effects, directing, you're faced with, on any project, thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of micro decisions, right? So you're making all of these micro decisions as to where a music edit was going to come
everything
in,
and anything.
How you going to phrase something, what the level is of one instrument relative to another, whatever it might be. And if your meter is off 1 millimeter, you apply that 1 millimeter to 100,000 decisions.
Awesome.
That could be the difference between a great movie and something that just doesn't work. The whole thing shifts. Now, when you're in the pocket, I think your instincts are pretty much, your taste, let's just say, is what drives everything. You may have thought something out, intellectualized it, but in the end, like, ultimately, you're applying your taste.
And that's the word I've been using, that a lot of stuff comes down to, also in music, it's the taste of how does someone see the world? What is their cup of tea, in a sense? And that is applied, whether it's subliminally in their DNA, or matter of fact, these are my marching orders, follow me, guys, you know? And it is taste,
And so, like, there's a... And I think that Carpenter, there's a moment in Christine that I always look at and think, see, that's what cinema is. And it's the scene where the bully, I forget who he is, who's hysterical.
Cunningham, Buddy.
Buddy something, yeah.
How the fuck?
He looks like he's like 40 years old.
Yeah,
he's
awesome
in high school,
with the sideburns.
He's got the switchblade.
Yeah.
And he's getting chased by the car. And there's a shot where he's running down the road.
The fire on
and the car's on fire behind now. If you'd be on set, or if someone was kind of second guessing that, they say, well, why is he running down the middle of the road? He could just like veer off the road. It's a car, so if he just goes off the road, the car can't get him. That's logic taking over, but cinema's not about logic, you know. And you can pick apart things, there's all these, you know, ways that we can analyze the logic of a character, but that's just a great image, right? A guy running with a flaming car. That's what the movie
is
about.
It's funny you say that, because that there is the nightmare.
Yeah.
And
that's it.
It looks right and go with it. It looking back at a documentary on Close Encounters, Spielberg said he kept running into the problem of the mothership rising up over Devil's Mountain. And he was like, it's supposed to be coming down from space. And he was like, but I've always had it locked in my mind, yet both sides of his brain are talking, and the visual effects people are like, Steven, it's mothership's coming down from the clouds you established. You're having this. And he's like, it's just, I'm sticking with my gut. It's cinema. That's the moment that it's a reveal.
Yes.
And I thought, that's absolutely right. Like that, a lot of times I think you have to be careful in making a film or putting together images that the thing that got you there, everything starts getting built around it. And that initial spark is in danger of being omitted because it got you importantly to where you are, but everything else is structurally more sound. And that spark is no longer valid. It may be really important to hang on to that spark because that image is so strong, defy reality. Like, why is Buddy, that's his name, yeah. Buddy, running dead center
Buddy
in the
Ravel.
Street.
Yeah. Buddy Ravel. Yeah. Buddy
He's
Ravel.
Running dead
Buddy
center and they're cross-cutting. And that dummy, when it runs over.
Yeah. And it's on fire.
And you give it so much room for dummies to suck. And that thing looks so good burning, you know.
Well,
yeah,
it's what
that's
you
absolutely
said,
true.
And I think it's what you said is probably tapping into it is dreams, right?
Yeah.
Because your dreams don't have logic, but your dreams have these images.
Yeah, and if you were to tell someone in your dream you said you were running down the road in a burning car, no one's going to ask you, were you on the side of the road? Was there a curb? Why didn't you turn up? Yeah, yeah. It's like, oh my God, you're running down the road. What happens on a road? A car is on a road. You're in the crosshairs. So exactly. I don't know how conscious people get of that, but you're going back to the archetype, back to the subliminal, and maybe that's the best way to communicate because we all remember that.
That's right. And like you say, I remember the mothership rising above.
Mm-hmm.
And when I watched it, I didn't question it.
I didn't question it till he brought it up 20 years later. Right, I'm like,
exactly.
Oh yeah, right. Yeah.
I'm like, holy shit, what a reveal.
Oh, wow.
You know, so that is, and I think going back to Carpenter, anyone like Carpenter just thinks cinematically, and that came across, and there was something about that coming across in these, something like Halloween, Assault on Precinct 13, you know, again, my brother and I were young. That moment when the girl goes to order the vanilla swirl.
One of the most iconic scenes in history.
And it's just like, boom. And we're like, holy shit, I can't believe I saw that.
That goes back to what you were saying when you get the corporate involved. Because in the remake, what scene wasn't in it?
Yeah, there's no way that's going to be.
You know what I mean? Yeah. Shooting a little. And that's the, as a kid, that's the scene every. That's a lot of movies, though. Like Evil Dead.
But
when you hear Sam Raimi in interviews, he's like, I would never have had the rape scene. I'm like, that's the scene that made everyone watch the fucking movie.
Yeah.
As good as Evil Dead is, a tree, an image of raping a woman, a fucking tree.
Right.
Nobody ever saw that in a movie or anything like that. So when you see an image, that's what makes people watch the movie.
Well, you can argue for it because it's set up. It's not out of place. It's telling you these guys have no morals. If they're going to take out a little girl, you're in real trouble when you're pitted against them.
That's right. You've set the level of evil. Now it's interesting because, like, I made Universal Soldier Day of Reckoning, right? And that the movie is all about. It's a revenge tale against about a guy who's implanted with a false memory of a violent crime happening to his loved ones as a way to set him up to go take a guy out. So the opening has to be utterly horrific. And it's this, you probably remember,
point
of view kind of reference of a guy dealing with a home invasion where his wife and daughter are dragged out in front of him and executed in front of him.
It's what I love because right from the beginning, you're like, this isn't Universal Soldier. This is a little something different than that. Oh, shit.
And Jean-Claude Van Damme executing. So the guy is a hero. And now, that was in 2011, 12.
Yeah.
I've had two young daughters since then. I don't know that I could make that scene now. I would come up with I don't know that I could go there now, but the movie's better for it because I wasn't able to go there.
Well, that's interesting.
So how do you feel about that, to self-analyze that?
I think that is real to
consider things in a different way.
It is. I think what it means is like, to what's like the Sam Raimi point, and it's maybe the Carpenter point. Maybe he still would do it.
I interviewed Carpenter. Yeah. And I brought up that scene. He's like, you can't kill kids. He actually said that. And I was like, that's the point.
So I think the point of it is that you do some things at certain points in your life that, I mean, a movie that I made 2 years ago, I wouldn't make it the same way now. Yeah. And the movie back then is probably better for it. Now, hopefully, I'm going to come up with something later that I wasn't able to do then. But
yeah, that's what I was going to say, is maybe the benefit of that is if you're growing emotionally where you don't want to touch upon that because it'll sting you too much, if you're creative, it's just going to, now that door is shut, find another one that has the same impact.
That's right.
What you communicates see, you the same intensity in a different way.
What was the scene from 2 years ago that you already switched up that you wouldn't have done?
It's less about a scene, more just to say, like, I rewatched, like, my movie Alone just arrived it's on a good Netflix film. Recently, right? Like, that was just on
the
Netflix.
The actress was great in the movie, too. Oh, yeah. She did great. What's her name?
Jules Wilcox.
Yeah, I think I said, wow, she was
and
great.
Mark Menchaca. Yeah, just showed up on Netflix. It's a number two movie on Netflix for some reason. So we're getting a little Netflix boost. And so it was on, and last night I just was like, oh, it's on
Let's
there.
See
and
what I was up to.
What was I up to? Yeah. And I watch it, and I think the interesting thing is you watch stuff that you did before, and with enough distance, I'm not like, oh, that sucks. I'm more like, that's pretty interesting, but I don't even remember doing that. Or I don't remember,
what got you there? Yeah, they're emotional capsules.
I wouldn't have made it the same way today. And not saying it would be better now. It might be worse. But whatever it's very, if I watch like Day of Reckoning, which I watched a few years back and was like, whoa, I can't believe we did this. This is pretty gnarly. But I'm glad I did it then. Yeah, but you become, it's just like doing musically, right? Yeah, like whatever you were doing 5-10 years ago, you've moved on.
Yep.
So you could, Radiohead could do the bends again. Not trying to put myself in it. I'm just saying to make a musical reference. I listen to The Bends. I'm like, The Bends is an awesome album. I love it.
Yeah.
But if you ask Tom York, he's like,
they'll dismiss it. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I don't need to make that again. Yeah. I did it. So
well, I think it also speaks to the importance, let's say in film, that if you're making a film and you're sitting on it, you're not finishing it, and it's because it's too big of a reach or too emotional to put your wrists out there, and time starts ticking by. There's many dangers of that, but one is finish it, put it out there. It is an emotional time capsule. Yeah. And the thing is, you got to have the first, you got to have the second, and you do change. And you'll probably never put it out if too many years go, because it'll be an alien thing to
you.
Right. You're like, I don't know who that person is. It's not reflective. And not that it's an excuse, but time does make things different. So it's wonderful to have it wrapped up in a barcode on it.
That's
and
right.
then let it go. You
yeah,
know?
Like would Scorsese, I mean, I'm sure if you asked him, would he...
Raging Bull.
Well, like would he make Taxi Driver the same way today? No, probably not, because he's just grown and learned different things and he's got a different perspective. But like Taxi Driver is perfect, right?
Yeah,
you know,
yep.
And it's a movie that I think... Everyone looks at anyone who's ever been involved in film is one of the most inspiring things ever, just to, in that same way of a carpenter shooting the kid, like how do you make a movie where this guy is, I don't know if he's the hero, but he is, we're with him.
And I think
Cronenberg, he was learning how to make movies while he was making the movie. So when I talked to him, I interviewed him, we talked about Rabbit, how great it is. And the earlier stuff. And he kind of, he was, I think because he became such a better technician, technically, but I enjoy some of his not perfect, technically, films better than some of his technically perfect
films.
And
I think people should understand that, because that comes with prestige and money and experience and knowing you're going to demand for a better lens set and stuff. But, some of the films that are most impactful, the rawness, the independence, even the clumsiness to me, make them more potent if they're successful, because it's that declaration of independence. It's going to happen no matter what. And that's just filled with heart, and you get excited by it. And you're like, that guy's real. That film was going to get done no matter what. And he'll learn on the next one and he'll learn again. But when they have that kind of tenacity, totally echoes on me if I like those films. I'm sure there are great films that were a big fight and I'd be like, I don't care about that. You know, it's not my cup of tea.
I think it's like, and that's why I've kind of changed the way I like, when I used to try and like learn about someone's filmography, okay, start at the beginning and then you work your way through. Now I like to start where they are and work my way back.
Wow,
you know,
cool. That's
because if you start, I did remember doing that with like Michael Haneke, you know,
I got really
into what he
Piano
was doing.
Teach is one of my favorites
it's amazing.
Of all time.
Funny games.
So you're indoors, obviously you like a certain film first. This is great. Let me see what got him here.
Yeah, and
have
if
you
move
did
backwards.
The
Haneke's?
Did you ever
you
look through Haneke's work? I think you might like some of it.
Yeah.
I mean, he's a master in many ways, and I think, and what he does is, and what I learned from him, because, you know, I was an editor, as you know, while when I was coming again, start out in the documentary, you got to be the editor because you can't afford to keep an editor on that long. So I was editing all my early ones and started watching his movies, and I realized kind of the power of a cut and the power of withholding the cut. And he was such a master of
just just letting it ride.
And like hanging it over you because you're like waiting for him to blink, you know, waiting for him. And he's sort of torturing you with like withholding the cut. Like,
what's the best gateway for me to
Well, I love The Piano Teacher, but people love Funny Games. Yeah. And Cachet, people really love that
Funny
one.
Funny Games is the home invasion?
Yeah. Oh,
And what's the one? Benny's video. Benny's video.
So you know. I think you go back. I think Piano Teacher is a great place to start, or Cachet. I would start with one of those because they're you know, Cachet is like a thriller in essence, and it's fairly accessible, a European kind of thriller. But it obviously goes in ways you would never imagine.
Right.
And it's a very kind of deliberate type of movie. It's not like high paced and it's not twisted violent turn, or crazy, but it's emotionally violent, you know, and you watch just the way, what a master he is of what image he's showing you and for how long.
Right, really and considered.
It's so considered, and it's really masterful. Wow. And I think
cool.
Cachet is a good one to start with. Yeah. And it definitely has a big, like, holy shit moment. You know, it's got that.
I think I'll go for any genre if I know that there's one voice behind that is specific about, you know, like it's amazing to me. A lot of filmmakers aren't editors or haven't edited somewhere in there. And I'll sometimes be on shoots as an effects guy. And sometimes an editor is giving notes from the day before. And I'm like, how is the director not seeing the movie already?
Yeah.
You know, it's like, you know, and I get it that some aren't interested, some aren't there for it, some lean on the editor more. I just think you'd be so much more valuable, and it's just a chance to nuance it more if you exactly know, especially if you're having fun with your transitional cuts and getting funky, you know?
Well, everything. Yeah, to me, I think it was the sculptor in me that was like, editing is where you're building the thing.
Yeah, it's
you're
funny. I often say, the overview of an entire film is a sculpture.
Yeah.
Because when you're adding and you're taking away in sculpture, and you're considering and you're spinning it and you're looking at it in different light, and you're looking at it as a commercial artist, you're looking at it selfishly. You know, all those things are what you're doing as a director. I think there's a DNA strand in there where they're very closely linked.
I agree.
We got him to 1 o'clock. I kept you past your time.
Yeah.
Do I got time for one more question?
Yeah.
So before we ask Adam, we said, what movie when you were young, like, screwed your whole head up, scarred you? It was too brutal, too something that really disturbed you or hurt you or made you, you know, something.
You know? Yeah, like disturbed me to the point. Okay. I mean, it's so many of them, but
one you remember being a kid, like, oh, this is too much, man?
Well, I would have to go back to, you know, it's interesting because there's the ones that were scared the shit out of me, but that thrilled me. And then there was the ones that were, but you know what? This is the weirdest thing. I'm going to say this. There was this movie that again, is not the goriest. It was nothing, but it fucked me up as a kid, and it was called Burnt Offerings.
Yeah, of course.
And there was something about...
Was it the pool scene, or...?
It was... Honestly, it was the driver. It was the limo driver guy with the little round glasses, and he had this smile.
I think they zoom in on him.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. And there was something... And it was like Karen Black and Oliver Reed in this movie. Yep. And to this day, because I haven't seen it in so long, I can barely remember, like, the plot of the movie or any of these things. But that the image of that guy was like seared in my nightmares for so long. And I remember really well that there was something about, and I think it was part of that was what attracted me to horror. But like I could watch Friday the 13th and Maniac and all that stuff. And I could kind of enjoy them for the makeup effects that were going on. But that almost distanced me from the horror of it. And it was something like that that was just really psychological.
Yeah,
it
doing
was
the
like,
opposite, pulling you in. There
was no gore or anything. And there was something about that that really like got into my bones. Wow, so wow. I would say that something random. I'd love to rewatch Burnt Offerings.
Well, you, it's interesting that film. Is when I originally saw it, it had a lot of impactful stuff. But the scene in the pool,
yeah,
I was getting it. I love anything shot underwater, and I do underwater photography.
Oh, cool.
So I love looking at it that way. But then becoming a parent, rewatching that. I'm like, that's what this scene is about. It's the dad is thrashing the kid, drowning him. And yes. I'm like, it's the Shining style. You've taken the pyramid of trust and safety, and it's being violated there. And it just hit at a completely different level. Because I didn't watch it probably in 15, 20 years.
Yeah.
And I'm like, shit, that scene's the standout to me now. Yeah, and I'm like, absolutely. Oh my God. And I realize that's the wonderful thing about revisiting films. And if you're talents take you in different categories, I'm like, that's what the director's doing in this. He's hitting a nerve that I didn't have that synapse before I was a parent, yeah. You know? And now I'm like, oh my God, wow, that's so effective.
You ever tried to watch a Bergman film when you're 15, 16? You're like, this sucks. Yeah. What the fuck is this bullshit? Yeah. Then you hit 30, 40, you're like, wow, this is kind of real shit. Well, you
know? It's like my younger brother, Greg, we're all into music. And sometimes he'll say, well, I just bought this jazz collection. We're like, oh, and he goes, I know I'm going to love it one day. Yeah. Like, that's really smart. He knows already the trajectory of coming around to it.
That's it.
Thank you for your time,
thanks,
man.
So
I don't want to keep you too much.
It was
much
a pleasure.
It was great meeting you finally in person. We've been in touch
absolutely.
For years. And
great
real pleasure.
Great,
yeah,
great.
Fantastic.
Nice to meet you.
That was awesome about Capricorn 1. If they ever do a Blu-ray new commentary, you know who to call now for that one. He knows
I'll
every shot.
More than
you know
about.
More than exactly. All right, well, pleasure.
Cool, come here.
Thanks, buddy.
Thank you.
Love it.
Thank you for your kind words.
Oh, and no. I look forward to seeing your movie.
Do you guys want to do a couple phone calls? Or you're out of here, too?
No, I can hang for a few.
All right.
You know.
Cheers.
Awesome. Thank you.
Good stuff.
Great stuff.
Real pleasure.
All right.
Real pleasure.
Yeah. Take
care. Good chat with you guys.
Hey, so don't forget, Suicide Disco, RATheRuggedMovie@gmail.com. If there's any investors... There's a crowdfunding up as well that has perks and stuff like this. And it's been a pretty good show so far. Do we know how to take phone calls?
Yes,
do we?
I'm putting it on the screen.
Oh, wow. We're going to take a couple phone calls. If it was Facebook, we'd have more calls, but I didn't know how to log into my Facebook. I'm, you know. But do people watch YouTube? Are people actually watching right now? Okay.
Lots of people tuned in. Lots of comments.
Oh, cool. Abel Ferrara. It went pretty good, right?
It was wonderful.
Yeah, that was great. My favorite part was you and him going in and out about Capricorn 1. You know, because I'm unfamiliar with the film. I know the film, I know who's in it. But
it's excellent.
I think I watched
it
once when I was young, and I can't remember, you know, I don't know much about it anymore.
It's an example of the director completely in control, making every right decision. And I'll tell you, it the apple doesn't fall from the tree. The smashing machine... Is it's so interesting
that, oh,
he did that.
Oh, that's my second part, too, that I loved. That
because,
you were
like,
what?
Wow. It's, I don't, I love documentaries, and I have a few. That one kind of will stump people as to why that's there. No pun intended, stump people. But, that's amazing. It's
also,
really
when
great.
He was bringing up Friday the 13th, I want to say, oh, Gabe worked on Friday the 13th, part four. And he's
six.
Mm-hmm. Oh, six. And he's down with Joseph Zito from part four, but he worked on six. I didn't mean to screw it up. I like four better than six. I know some people have six as their favorite, and some people have two as their favorite. I kind of
rock. Four is good, too, yeah.
Four is my favorite, but six is good, too. But it was like the comedy one.
You can just read it. It's on the screen.
Oh. Oh, 323-815-4204. We're going to be on for another 10 minutes or so taking calls. Suicide Disco. Those phone lines are not lighting up.
Not yet. We just put it up. Some of the information on the
text here
on the screen.
Bang. Look at that.
When
Bang.
Did you start writing the script, Ari?
Bang. I started writing a script. I was working on a movie, a script for 6 months, and I thought it was great, and I thought I had all these great ideas. And then it just kept sucking. You know, it was like a bunch of what I thought were interesting ideas, and the script just didn't work. And so I did a rewrite, read it again, it didn't work.
So how do you check yourself? How are you in it and immersed, excited? What's your stepping back process?
Well, you go, you know what? This doesn't work. And usually you could solve the problems. You go, okay, you know, we'll make this work. And I don't know. I think it was just a script that had too many ideas. So I think if I ever go to rewrite that one, I'm just going to take a whole lot of shit out and go with the basic ideas that I think work. So that's all it took. So I was about to start doing that. Like, you know what? We're going to empty it out a little bit. And then I wrote the opening to Suicide Disco randomly. I'm like, random scene. Oh, this is easy to write. Boom, boom. And now they meet each other. And I wrote that thing in 8 days. And it just came out of me. And then I sent it to some of my writer friends, you know, like some of the guys that are selling scripts and all this stuff and doing really great. And I said, hey, I wrote something pretty strange. I was laughing out loud while I was writing it. I think it's interesting. I probably got to do some rewrites, but what do you think? And every single person I sent it out to was like, I love it, I love it, I love it. I'm like, that one? The one I wrote in 8 days? Mm-hmm. So that's how that happened. And then, you know, all the stuff that was making me laugh out loud, I thought I was just writing it for me, like, you're an asshole. I'm going to change that later, obviously. And those are the scenes that people really loved. And I loved them while I was writing them. So, you know.
I think that's interesting. If you say that it was making you laugh and you're the audience, it's probably a little different and a little more encouraging because you're also a public performer. So yeah. What you put out is already a piece of you, and you get direct response, whether it's record sales or a live audience. So yeah. Something has to tell you that your voice, if it's making you laugh, isn't wrong.
Or
at least has an excuse to keep moving forward with it.
I'm also known for making stupid jokes and laughing at them, and nobody laughs in the room. Mm-hmm. So you never know. I laugh at shit that's not funny, so I'm not that confident that just because I'm laughing that you people will like it. But I think we're good. The idea that films appeal to subconscious as an explanation for not reflecting any logic reality is both profound and now obvious to me. Fear isn't rational, so what's the sense of rationalizing horror?
Yeah, I think there's a lot to that because, you know, our subconscious is processing so many things that allow us to navigate as human beings. And we have to step forward every day with a lot of very realistic fears that come at us, and we compartmentalize them and move ahead. Getting in the car, you know, having families, you know, pursuing what you're going to do at the risk of financial collapse. So if those basics are baked in, and then if you amplify them to becoming anxiety to horror, and if you could keep considering that when you write or make a film, it does make sense that you're onto something. It'll resonate past the viewing experience, and you'll consider it more. I know the stuff I'm most impacted by, it sticks with me. I'm thinking about it, and it's not based on a specific visual. It's a scenario. It's a series of events that have created a moment that is a nightmare, and it has all the benefits of a nightmare: anxiety, no way out, stress, suffocation. So I think there's something to it. If you could start getting that encompassed in a cinematic scene in a moment, you got something cool.
Cool. Let's take a phone call. We're almost done for the day.
Mark Lee Studios.
You're on. Yeah, I'm calling for the show.
We can't hear him. We can't hear him.
So that's right. I'm calling for the chef. And then, you know, all the stuff that makes me laugh
out loud. Oh, we don't have headphones. Yeah. Give us a second. Stay on the line.
Is that his hat?
No, that's mine.
Is that yours? Thanks.
All right, let's see what we got here. Talk. Oh, but I can't hear it.
Yeah, you should be able to hear it.
I can't hear it.
You got a knob here?
Oh, right here. Yeah. No, I don't hear it.
No, the other one, the one that you're plugged into. Oh, I didn't plug you in. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Here, there's a.
Can you hear?
You should be able to hear him talk.
Hey, so talk to us. Talk radio. You ever seen an Oliver Stone movie?
Do more Immortal Technique and Vinny Paz, please.
You said something about Immortal Technique?
Do more songs with Immortal Technique and Vinny Paz.
All right. Thank you, sir. We'll do more songs with Immortal Technique and Vinny Paz. Next call or next comment. Thank you, sir. You got any more comments or... They Live is just killer Carpenter, like nothing else before and after. Yeah, we love They Live. Give us another one, and then we're going to call it a day. Throw us a couple more comments, right? And then we'll call it a day.
Sure.
Hey, R.A., I was at your show in Montreal recently, and I was... R.A., you're one of the best to ever bless the mic. Now, do we got cinematic stuff? Karen Black and Capricorn 1. Still got Bad Biology DVD. Dope. Sequel to... Oh, The Force. Go to that one. The Force 1985 is one of my favorites. I've got it on DVD. Love from Holland. Can't wait to see him. And okay. Well, good. Hey, I love you guys. Go to the site. Gabe Bartalos is on the effects. Suicide Disco. We're filming July and October, Norway and Belgium. Shout out to everybody involved. Lynn Christensen, my DP Julian, the castle in Belgium. We love you. My investors, Frank and Pat, or Pat, but I can't say the other investor. I got another investor that's a secret investor. He doesn't want me to reveal him till later. I'm going to post about that later. But everybody, if you want to invest, ratheruggedmovie@gmail.com or go to the Crowdfunding Suicide Disco. And much love. I hope you enjoyed the film discussion. Any last words, Gabe?
No, that was a blast.